Please join with me with the Pledge of Allegiance.
Pledge of Allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. The first thing we have tonight is a Recognition of Service Award. Sandy, would you come up? Is a recognition in service, recognition, a resolution in recognition of service. Whereas Sandra Nickerson has served the people in the town of Hampton with dedication and loyalty as a member of the Municipal Pledge Committee from 1988 to 1991, from 2000, 2001, 2014, and 2015. And whereas Sandra Nickerson has served with distinction, providing guidance, leadership, during her terms as a member of the Municipal Budget Committee. And whereas Sandra Nickerson has served the town above and beyond the call of duty many times, many occasions, often at personal sacrifice. Be resolved that the selectmen and the citizens of Hampton make known their appreciation of the services that Sandra Nickerson has rendered to the town of Hampton. Whereunto we have set our hands this seal in the 28th day of March, the year of our Lord, 2016, and the 377th year, the incorporation of the town of Hampton, and the 337th year of the founding of the state of New Hampshire, and the 239th year of the independence of the United States of America, signed by the Hampton Board of Selectmen. Thank you very much.
Thank you all very much. Really appreciate it.
Thank you.
And I just want to say one thing, and I won't make a real speech, but I just want to say one thing. I was out walking my grandson the other day, Noah, and we happened to go by the fire department, and he wants to be a fireman. And as we were taking our little pictures of the day, there was a training class that came out, and I went up to the fellow, and I said, if he wants to be a firefighter, can we possibly get a picture? And they said, yep, but you know, we're kind of like in the middle of the class right now. And so we had to wait a little bit, but we got a picture, and I posted it out on Facebook. So I just wanted to let you guys know that, you know, you've got a great department, all your employees are terrific, and for them to stop, maybe they wanted a little break, but, you know, it made his day. I mean, 20 years when he's a Hampton firefighter, he'll have something to, something really special to remember.
Like very this. Nice.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Guys.
Thank you, Sandy.
Thank you.
So the next thing is public comment period. Anybody from the public would like to speak?
Good evening. Norman Silberdick, 17 Tide Mill Road, representing the Rational Taxpayers of Hampton. Originally, I had asked for an appointment tonight with the selectmen to discuss the encumbrances and other items of interest to Rational Taxpayers. And I had followed up our conversation 2 weeks ago with a letter to Fred, who indicated there was another bidder on the TV systems for the police department, and I asked for additional documentation on that. And subsequently, Mr. Welch informed me on Friday that that was an error, there was no other bidder. And I saw in the agenda that Mr. Gerald was to speak tonight, and I noticed that my name was canceled with a line through it, which is proper, and Mr. Gerald was totally taken off the agenda list as if he hadn't been there. I think it was your instruction last week that he was to appear to present his findings on reviewing the encumbrances, and now that's missing. The reason I took myself off the appointment list because I wanted to have an interaction with the board as a result of his discussion, and if I was speaking first and he was speaking eighth or ninth, it really would have been a one-sided conversation. So I prefer that I'd like to make another appointment with the board, but at the same time be able to interact with Mr. Gerald, presuming that he will present on the 23rd. We continue to to believe that the encumbrances that for year end were improper, and nothing has changed our mind on that. And there's another confusing item, which is the award of the to Howard Systems for the phone system. And whereas at year end it was listed as Hampton Technical for $27,000, and we presume it was encumbered, and all of a sudden it's coming back in with another vendor, which means it couldn't have been legally binding obligation at the end of the year. And I really would like to see this issue resolved, cleaned up, and proper accounting and business practices followed. It's, again, it's not that we're opposed to any particular item. We just don't like the procedure. You're supposed to vote on anything over $50,000. You're supposed to give your concurrence on the purchase of it. And you didn't even, and that hasn't happened with a couple of these items. And that's just not the proper way of handling business for the taxpayers and for the town of Hampton. Thank you.
Thank you. Anybody else would like to speak? Yes, Kathy. Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Kathy Terry. I'm a resident of Hampton, Lawrence Court. I'm here this evening representing the Seabrook Emergency Management Team and Maria Brown to extend an invitation to the selectmen, the town manager, fire chief, and police chief, if they would like to attend an event that is happening at the end of May in Seabrook. I just want to give a few facts and explain exactly what the event is about. In 2013, there were 193 fatal drug overdoses in the state of New Hampshire. In 2014, that number jumped to over 300, with the demographics shifting sharply from middle-age victims to young adults ranging in age from 17 to 30. As of December 1st, 2015, the state medical examiner said there have been 295 deaths connected to opioid use, but the projected number of drug-related overdoses could pass 357 once the somewhat 80-plus suspected overdose cases are confirmed. Unfortunately, we don't have hard numbers today, but from the information we have been able to gather from the drug overdose deaths, the drug overdose deaths in the state of New Hampshire for the year 2016 are projected to be well over 400. We are very fortunate that the Mark Wahlberg Youth Foundation has chosen Seabrook to be one of the communities here on the seacoast to screen their documentary film In If Only, in the hopes to raise awareness about the opioid epidemic attacking not only our seacoast communities but the entire country. If Only was financed and supported by the Mark Wahlberg Youth Foundation and Millennium Health. The 38-minute film is intended for teens, parents, and adults to raise awareness about the dangers of prescription drug misuse and abuse, and to start a conversation that encourages the safe use, storage, and disposal of prescription drugs to keep them out of the hands of our kids. Again, this film, If Only, is being screened at the Seabrook Community Center on Tuesday, May 24th at 6 p.m. There will be a free meal as well as free child care. Originally, the free tickets were able to be reserved online because we are so close to the capacity that the community center holds. Anyone interested, be it the selectmen or the chiefs or any residents of Hampton, I would request that you give me a call at my number, and that is 603-770-2939. We'd like to accommodate as many people as possible. I think this is a really, really important and riveting evening for our community. I've only seen the 2-minute trailer for the film, and I can tell you that it's pretty powerful. James Wahlberg, who is Mark Wahlberg's brother, will be there. He's the producer as well as the executive director of the Mark Wahlberg Youth Foundation, and we're happy to have him as a guest that evening to talk about the film and to be part of a panel discussion afterwards. So we are going to have a forum afterwards. We have what we consider 9 really great local experts that will be there to answer questions and give out information. So again, I'd just like to thank you for giving me this time to explain that. that, and again, extend the invitation. And anyone that would like to come, please contact me.
Thank you, Kathy.
Does anybody have any questions? Or
no, I've seen your flyer before, and I think you've put it out there. Is anybody else?
Maybe just say that telephone number again slowly.
Certainly, sure, sorry. 603-770-2939. And like I said, we'd be happy to accommodate as many people as we possibly can.
Very informative. Thank you.
All right. Thanks again.
Is anybody else from the public would like to speak?
Jerry Zanoy here, 16 Presidential Circle in Hampton. I'm here tonight because I saw that EPW was on your agenda for discussion of the marsh pipes. My problem with the marsh pipes, if you will, is that I don't really have any problems with money spending if I think it's truly justified. I do not in this case, as of right now anyway. We put those pipes in some number of years ago. And the moment we put them in, we took on a risk because they go under the marsh. The moment we put them in, we took a risk on. After looking at this pipe for an extended period of time, looking at the pipe very carefully in the rock and so on, I can't say that that risk is increased appreciably. I'm going to give you some facts. I looked at the damaged pipe. It was down at Church Street Pump Station. They had brand new pipes down there as well. They must have bought some extra pieces or had them on hand. The new ones had a bituminous bonded coating on them, 50,000 thick. The wall thickness was a half an inch. The pipe that we took out of the marsh, the wall thickness was 3/8 of an inch. Talking about 125,000 thinner over 29 years. The concrete liner inside the pipe on the new pipe, it's a half an inch. On this pipe, it was 3/8 of an inch. We're talking about an 1/8 inch thicker on the concrete liner was thinner. New wall, it's a half inch or an 1/8 inch, and the concrete liner on the damaged pipe was 3/16. So we were a 60 thousandths thinner on the liner. To me, this is not a this is just wear, in my opinion. Wear. This is not appreciable wear. I did notice. Oh, I also looked at the inside of the pipe, and I looked for sulfuric acid attack at the crown of the pipe. Did not see any. This is sometimes happens with wastewater treatment plants. Shouldn't have seen it because this is a pressure force main, and I didn't see it. I did see pebbles, sand, and gravel inside the pipe, which is bedding material that the pipe laid on. I will say this, the trench and embedment specifications are very defined, and no rock larger than 2 inches in diameter is allowed in the embedment material, which has to be 4 inches deep that the pipe sits on. So, you know, the pipe itself wasn't in bad shape at all. The rock, let's look at the rock. I picked up the rock. It's a heavy rock. It was like granite. But I tried to scrape it to validate that. I couldn't do it. It was just heavily coated with marsh material on whatever. And I didn't want to break it in half. That's a failure specimen. I'd have to work with DPW before I did anything like that. To me, it struck me as a part of ledge or bedrock that the marsh sits on. The rock may have broken away from a ledge, worked its way right through erosion process, through the embedment material, and into the pipe. That's my thinking on it. Over time, the oscillations of the pipe, when it's processing 900 gallons a minute of wastewater, and the pressure of that rock to continue to move up where it causes a crack and a hole in the pipe, that's what caused the defect. This is my conjecture on that, and I can say this, that I've done a lot of work on the internet looking at the ductile iron specifications and so on, taking photographs of the whole thing. We don't have enough facts here to say spend $3 million or $4 million or $5 million. We just don't have enough. We need to do some non-destructive testing to see if we are in the middle of a rock field. We can do that through ultrasonics, or we can do it through ground-penetrating radar, or maybe magnetics. We can do that. That could be done. We can see if we are in the middle of a rock field or not. or if there's any rock closer than 6 or 9 inches from a pipe, which we cannot have per the specifications. We can see that. We can go look for that. We need to know that. If we're not in a rock field and don't have any more perils or risk, then that issue is out.
Can you
wrap up?
Wrap up, please.
I'm of the opinion right now, we have no sense of emergency or imminent failure in our midst here until we get more facts. And I certainly wouldn't endorse spending any money on this issue until we have the facts. I wouldn't be able to endorse it. Thank you.
Thank you. Anybody else like to speak? Yes, sir.
Sir?
How are you tonight?
Good evening. Richard Rennie of 29 Highland Ave. I do see on your agenda that the Director of Public Works is here, Chris Jacobs. And I thought that this would be a good opportunity to me to readdress or revisit a problem that has cropped up that this reorganized board and the new member may or may not be aware of. And that is the continuing flooding of property and the street at the foot of Highland Ave and Brown Ave. Just for a little history on this whole thing, off of Charles Street, which is off of Church, is a wetland. And extending from that wetland all the way along the back properties of Kentville Terrace, Ross Ave, Chase Court, and some of the properties of Highland Ave is a trench. Whether you call it a trench, a swale, a ditch, or whatever, but the flow, there is a flow of water from that wetland along that ditch all the way down to the intersection of Brown Ave and Highland Ave, and there's a tide gate there. And I understand that the purpose of that tide gate is to control the flow of water back and forth through that ditch. I don't know whether it's supposed to let it in or let it out or whatever. But it's my understanding that that tide gate is not working. And that's pretty much evidenced by what you see in that area during an astronomical high tide. That swale fills up, overflows, and extends out onto the street and into the backyard properties of the street of the streets that I mentioned. And there's also another problem. When that occurs, it also floods a portion of the Church Street parking lot. So you look at two things here. You look at the destruction, if you will, of the backyards of some of these properties, and also the loss of the revenue in that parking lot. Because there's no way when that parking lot is flooded in that area that you could get cars in and out of there. And I hate to see it happen that that parking lot could be full, high tide comes along, and that whole entrance is blocked, and you're going to have a problem. So I guess maybe to try and revisit this, to bring this to your attention, and this matter has been brought to a number of agencies. I understand it's been brought to the town, the Department of Public Works, state agencies, and nobody seems to want to take responsibility of who is to maintain that ditch, which means it has to be cleaned out. It's choked up with vegetation, and that is inhibiting the flow of the water. So I just want to bring that to your attention again. Hopefully there may be something can be done to get that cleared out, get that water properly flowing through the wetland, along that ditch, and in and out of the tide marsh, to alleviate the problem of the damage that is being caused to the properties and also for the loss of revenue in that parking lot. Thank you.
Thank you, Rich. Is there anybody else who would like to speak? Seeing none, thank you. I will bring it to the board for announcements and community calendar.
I have nothing, Mr. Chairman.
Nothing right now.
Nothing. Thank you.
Nothing, Mr. Chairman. Thank you.
I have two quick things. One, this Saturday, May 14th, the food drive for the post office, the postal workers, they're asking that you put non-perishable items in a bag by your mailbox on the 14th, and they will collect them. I know a lot of this food goes to a lot of the food pantries right here in Hampton, so the majority of it stays right here in town, so you can help them out. The second one I had was we received a copy of a thank you note. And again, we always get these for our firefighters. And this one was to Dean Sonas. And the lady just couldn't express how much she appreciated the fine work that our fire department did. And so I just wanted to carry that along. Okay, we have our consent agenda.
First one is 50 Ancient Highway, termination of lease, land lease. Number two is 50 Ancient Highway, new lease, land lease. Number three is entertainment licenses and posted permits. One is the Cloud Nine Bar and Grill. One is the Goat, the Wally's Pub, Bernie's Beach Bar, and North Beach Bar and Grill. Number four is a parade and public gathering licenses for the New Hampshire Tow Association for their trade show on May 22nd. Second one is the Smutty Nose 5K. We'll run for beer on 626. Number five is raffle permits. It's Professional Firefighters of Hampton. They're having a raffle on 526. B is the Hampton Arts Network. Number six is road closure request for Pine Road on 52916. Number seven is the use of electronic sign for Winnicott High School Relay for Life on January 9th to the 11th. June 9th to the 11th. January is going to be a little time early.
Yeah.
So I need a motion.
I'll make that motion.
Motion.
I'll second it.
Second it. All those in favor? Unanimous. Okay, now we will go to appointments. As Mr. Silberdick says, he canceled his own appointment. Number two is Ed Tinker, Chief Assessor.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Here to present the first installment of the 2016 tax warrants. The first warrant is in the amount of $27,058,994. Here to answer any questions or look for approval to that number.
Any questions from the board? Regina?
I have none.
What if we don't approve it?
We don't do it.
Let Donna know in the morning.
We keep
the
She's
listening right now, so we could say something.
Nothing.
Rick?
No.
Phil?
Negative, sir.
I guess we're all set. Okay. So do we need a motion?
Yes. I'll make that motion.
Motion to approve the first half property tax warrant. Seconded by Regina. All those in favor? Unanimous.
I do have one other item.
Go ahead.
It is under old business, and I don't know if I should wait for that. It's regarding HB 1198 that we've been dealing with regarding the pole and conduit. Did you want to discuss that later with Mark present, or?
Or do you want
to? I think
he's right behind you.
Well, we can do it now if you like.
He's here.
Is it okay if we do that
sure,
now
absolutely.
So that we can? I know it has a long ride.
No, I don't. It's only 15 minutes.
Yes,
oh,
he did.
Well, it is long. It's still long.
Okay.
It's not an hour and 15 anymore.
Okay, go ahead.
We update the board in that the Senate did pass HB 1198. we had many discussions about the effect that would have on Hampton based on the number of poles and conduit located in town. The report I gave you back in early March outlined some figures, estimated figures, where there would be a shift in property tax to the residential and commercial taxpayers. And I wanted to go over a few of those things just to let you and the public know.
Thank you.
We had originally stated that implementing HB 1198 would have an effect of approximately of $827,000 in assessed value relative to the telephone poles. And these are the poles that are owned by telecommunication companies, mainly Fairpoint and Hampton. It doesn't deal with the portion of the pole that would be owned by, or the poles owned by electric companies. And that's an issue we'll mention here before we finish. So basically, the first year, the potential loss in tax dollars, or at least shift in tax dollars, would be close to $16,000. Over a 10-year period, we're looking at close to $200,000 estimated in tax dollars that will be going away from the value associated with the poles and being shifted to, again, residential and commercial properties. One thing I did want to mention that I also did in this report was like a 10-year outline of loss in or shift in value, loss in tax dollars relative to a few things that have taken place over the past several years. One of them, of course, being now that HB 1198 has been passed. Also, it has to do with the pollution control exemption or the pilot program we entered into with NextEra Energy, and also the RSA 79E, which was relative to a tax reduction for the Sea Spray condominium, which was granted a five-year reduction in taxes, and that was applied to each and every condominium unit in that development. The main thing is that over those 10 years, and actually over 4 years between 2014 and 2018, we're seeing a loss of revenue, or at least a loss that needs to be made up in other areas of just over $1.2 million. If you look at it over a 10-year period, we're increasing that to over $2 million in loss revenue, or at least revenue that has to be shifted to other taxpayers. Mark may have some things he wants to discuss also, but that is kind of the gist of it. We're really not sure. It hasn't been signed by the governor yet, and there is some potential of that being vetoed. However, you know, that's something that maybe Mark can talk about a little more.
We had made the point at the Senate committee regarding the unconstitutionality of this bill. It basically is not classifying property, but classifying taxpayers for the same property, treating the telecommunications owner of the pole differently from the electric company owner of the pole. This has been something that the New Hampshire Supreme Court has given its view on before, and in a negative fashion, and in several cases has cited the Equal Protection Clause of the New Hampshire Constitution as grounds for finding a tax invalid. And so one of the senators at the committee actually raised the point in front of the Senate that this being unconstitutional, they should ask the New Hampshire Supreme Court for an advisory opinion, which is something that is built in our constitutional system. However, the Senate didn't go along with that, and that leaves it up now to the governor to either sign or not sign and veto. And there has been an instance in this legislative session where she has vetoed legislation. I would urge the board to authorize, affirm the direction to the manager to send a letter to the governor, which I believe may have already been done because of the need for speed, to ensure that at least that point is brought to her attention. And beyond that, we'll have some options if the legislation is signed by her to do some other items to bring this to the court's attention, because it surely is setting us up and many other municipalities for constitutional problems with the taxation of the same property differently to different taxpayers.
The one thing to remember, too, is that the majority of telephone poles in Hampton, approximately 95% of them, are co-owned, jointly owned, with Unitil, and that's the issue. The poles are going to be valued with two different methodologies, and that is the concern, or the you know, as to fair and equal taxation. So that's the issue that every town has, but we have a very large, close, you know, 95% of the poles being co-owned.
So one of the features of the legislation at the very end was to give the Department of Revenue Administration the ability to assign values to the poles, which it will do so through rules and rulemaking procedure, which would involve some public hearings. And that would be an additional time where some points can be made. DRA in many areas has been undervaluing utilities throughout the state and been called to task for the way it's done so in some major
tax cases in front of the Board of Tax and Land Appeals.
Okay, well, I'm going to allow Phil to start off with this, only because you've done an extreme amount of work on this, and I appreciate that.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman, and I'd like to thank Senator Stiles. And if you go to the Senate website, you can bring up HB 198 and thank her for her nay vote. Senator Feltz and you engaged in discussion about the constitutionality of that, spoke your legalese. But his point was clear in that there are constitutional issues about equal protection, and not just equal protection between two utility companies, but equal protection for the men and women that pay taxes in this town that also have real property. And our taxes go up. It is the same timber that constructs most of our houses that constructs their poles. It's just they don't need to maintain their poles. And while our values go up, Mr. Chenker has previously done an excellent job of demonstrating how our values increase. We have a reevaluation going on currently. Mm-hmm. While this foreign state corporation is going to enjoy accelerated depreciation. And as you say, Ed, with other utilities and other giveaways violating their strategic doctrine of maintaining our tax base, destroying our revenue in this town. And the New Hampshire Municipal Association has asserted that this will have to be made up by Hampton residents, honest, taxpaying citizens that don't have lobbyists. It will have to be made up both on the school side and the town side. So Senator Stiles from Hampton deserves all of our support and our thanks, along with David Pierce. Two Democrats voted for this or voted against this, as did Senator Stiles, so we thank her for her leadership. We thank Mr. Welch for his letter, dated May 5th, sent via email to the Honorable Governor of the state of New Hampshire. She has vetoed a bill most recently which had to do with code enforcement issues, and particularly this legislative piece, 1198, is two-pronged and a double-edged sword in an attack on both local revenue and on local government and local control, where Concord would suddenly establish your assessing. I don't know what the end game is, Ed. You might be nervous about your job. We think we'll keep you. But it appears that Concord, and no joke, is trying to assume your responsibilities. So we would urge the governor to veto this, as she has most recently vetoed another bill about local governance and local control. Additionally, there's an issue of fiscal impact. New Hampshire Municipal Association has protested against this. If you go to the Senate website and go to the oral or the audio, you'll hear Mr. Chenker, you'll hear our town council, Mr. Gerald, you'll hear a selectman speak on the fiscal impact. It's nonsensical, puerile, sophomoric governance. It specifically states that the bill is introduced may have an indeterminable impact on local expenditures. It's simply a falsehood. It wouldn't stand the test of any local child that had a paper route in this town. It certainly wouldn't rise to the metrics of professional governance, would not rise to the standard of any regulated industry, nor if you were to do something as simple as to buy a hamburger or a pizza in town. The vendor would tell you there's an indeterminable amount that will appear in your bill. Mr. Chenker, the town of Hudson, the New Hampshire Municipal Association are working to develop platforms that can respond, because clearly Mr. Booten, the chair of the Ways and Means Committee, we may politely say, needs our assistance in more ways than one. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you. Rick?
I think Phil said it all.
Okay. Regina?
I have nothing further.
Yeah, I get just a couple of things. I mean, I agree with what Phil said. The problem is, and Ed, you reached out to every other town to try and get them to join in this, and they didn't.
Right.
You had what? How many responses?
One.
The problem is, when Hampton and one other town goes up, what happens? You don't have the numbers to go up there and fight the legislation or to get their delegation to vote against it, which is a shame. I mean, and it's not our fault. I think, Ed, Mark and Phil did a great job going up there with facts, figures, and talking about it. But I didn't see a lot of school departments up there. A lot of SAUs go up there and complain about what was happening with their tax. And if you don't have that, you're not going to initiate change, which is a shame. And the other thing is, what I'm interested in, Mark, if this goes to court, who's going to be paying for it? The towns, or is the state going to be paying for this court case? If we get sued that the two the polls are, you know, owned in, by two entities, who's going to end up paying the court costs?
Well, it depends a bit on the context in which the case arises. There are several different places where that could arise. One is in the defense of how we tax Fairpoint in this case, which could be at the Board of Tax and Land Appeals or at the Superior Court. Another could be if towns banded together and filed a declaratory judgment action. It wouldn't necessarily be against the state necessarily, but those are some of the context.
So in effect, we could end up paying the court costs if it's against us.
Well, I wouldn't put it that way. You'd end up obviously paying for my time. That's for sure. The American rule, in which prevails in most court cases, is that each side pays its own attorney. This is not within those exceptions where the loser pays both sides, which is the case in England, for instance. This is not that case. When you say court costs, if you're not talking about attorney's fees, court costs are merely the filing fees in court.
Talking about attorney's fees, I hire specialists and we have to go out and get an energy attorney, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. I mean,
I think to be honest with you, this is not a case where that's so difficult to do that. We're not really talking the valuation itself. We're talking in terms of the unconstitutionality, the blatant difference in rating the same property.
And I agree with you 100%, and I agree with Senator Feltz when he said it. But why did other towns not join in on this?
I can answer that, and if I may, Mr. Chairman, and having been involved with this, and I've spoken with Cordell and Judy, and I've been up to their association twice, and they're looking for assistance. Ed is the president of the Assessing Association, is that correct? Your annual meeting is tomorrow, is that correct?
Monthly meeting, yeah.
You're going to help galvanize and lead, as Hampton often does in this state, this effort to develop those metrics for issues that are property-centric, that are revenue-centric, to develop those platforms with the towns in the state. Ed, this is part of leadership in your association, that you can provide this data. It doesn't mean everyone comes up to testify. It simply means we put a hole and we pierce this fiscal note process and get numbers. And it's a very easy fix.
And I agree. Yeah. But how many people responded when you asked just for their figures?
One.
Like, put together. I mean, that's what I'm saying.
But I think if we look at this early on and try to get, you know, these other assessors and communities to really look at these bills early on, maybe we can get numbers. I don't know. But, I mean, we could potentially get a little more
because it just
respond, a little better response.
I can remember it in the Romans and Meals when I was up in the State House. Portsmouth and Hampton. Portsmouth and Hampton. Portsmouth and Hampton. Those are the ones up there. And if that happens, there's not other towns up there, it's not going to happen. This right. summer when the committee met on changing the formula for rooms and meals. Portsmouth and Hampton, Portsmouth and Hampton, Portsmouth and Hampton. You know, there was a couple, maybe up in the mountains, there are a couple, but you don't get it. The other thing that I would caution against is I think this bill was passed veto-proof. If you look at the numbers in the House and you look at the numbers in the Senate, I mean, this can be vetoed, but that veto can be overridden very easily. So, I mean, in realistically speaking, I don't think a veto is going to be an option.
Right. I don't think a lot of towns. I know there was a lot of activity on the listserv, town manager, listserv administrator, town administrator listserv. I knew there was a lot of activity on that, but it didn't seem that there was much. Well, there was nobody there. Yeah. But there was word that there was a lot of activity on that and a lot of worries and concerns about this.
But you got to, you got raising concerns. You got to do what you guys did. You got to be up there. You got to be talking. You got to be lobbying for your own benefit.
Well, I think the numbers would have helped because, again, the representative, the DRA, made some statements to the minimal impact, this, that, and those items just those weren't facts. Those weren't true. Those, but nobody was there to contradict it other than us.
Yeah. I mean, the thing is, you know, our state senator heard us and advocated for Hampton. Other state senators have to hear from their people that I need you to get up there, I need you to do this, or else it's...
See, I think the thing with the bill is they talk about if the poll is going to be 700 or 800, people in that range should not see a difference, but that's really not the point of the 7-8, it's the depreciation. It can be 7-8 all day long, but that 20% depreciation...
Right.
You're at $120, $140. Yeah. That's not breaking even. So that's,
I agree, and I think I think we're on the right track, but we need other people to come with us.
Yeah.
Anything else? I guess we're all set.
Except for me.
Okay.
Thanks, guys.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Do you want to say anything about that?
No, they summed up.
Okay. Thank you. Next one will be Chris Jacobs and Jen Hale, a departmental update.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Wait, Ed must have felt like he was on the hot seat because this chair is warm. Wow. That's warm. Ooh. All right. I'm going to go through my departmental update while Jennifer's going to prepare the computer because the matrix for the force main, which is the second item we were going to discuss, she's got it prepared on computer. I did hand out earlier my summary so that you could follow through or follow along, and if there's any specific questions, please feel free. Our first quarter activities were, we had a blessing this year with only 25 inches of snow versus the over 120 we had last year. So in checking the budget today, we still have 13,000 remaining for sand, 54,000 for salt, and 41,000 for overtime labor, which will carry us through the fall and into the early part of the winter. It's last year we didn't have that luxury, so we're in a good position that way this year. Church Street Force Main, it was repaired on the 19th of March. To date, we spent $128,860, but we've also spent another $6,799 in testing and also some outside labor, and the same thing in March, another $6,121. We will continue to track these costs because we're buying additional lab supplies that we didn't normally purchase in the past, and additional labor to grab some of those samples, and then of course some of the analysis is actually done with outside lab. What we're testing for, along with Chris Nash at DS, is we're grabbing samples at Tide Mill Creek where the water flows under 101. In trying to keep a handle on that as a, if you will, an early warning system if we did have another issue come up with a force main, because that's how it was discovered before. I know on a couple of occasions here in the last 60 days, we're normally looking for a fecal count of 14 or lower, and we've had fecal counts as high as 450 and 130, but they only seem to last for a day or two. In one instance, we discovered that it was probably due to a dead seagull just upstream from the testing location. So it's highly, the fecal count in the river and in the bay are highly influenced by not just us with the force mains, but with other things going on in that environment. Capital improvements plan was submitted in May. Jen submitted some other revisions today. She also got the CMOM. That's our collection, maintenance, and operation plan. That's
Sorry.
Go ahead. No, go ahead.
Short person problem. I'm going to go right with something.
Yeah, right there.
Yeah, that's that one.
So that was submitted by Jennifer, and then we also got the small municipal systems are required to submit our stormwater management plan, and that was submitted called the MS4. Due on May 1, and that was been put in. We're very active in tree removals this year. We had three already removed at Carr Park, a large three-stem pine on Little River Road, another large dead pine on Little River Road, and another dead elm on that same road. It was a very large ash tree at 38 Acadia that was removed during the winter, and a dead maple over at the intersection of Lafayette and Winnicunnet. I point this out because in the past there's been a lot of discussion that maybe the department hasn't really spent the allocation for tree removal where it was needed. We've used it for other things, but I can tell you that that's not occurring now. We do have plans for five more trees at Founders Park. There's a lot of them with dead tops. My concern is that they could break off and injure someone severely. There's two dead trees at Lock Road Park that are going to be taken out. Two dead trees were identified out on Toll Farm Road between the James House where Campbell Snow Dump is, that area. If they came down, they'd take a lot of wires with them. And we have two trees scheduled for trimming, one over in Presidential Circle and one on Winnicunnet Road. They're very large and delicate oaks in both cases. Solid waste. You should be aware that in the first 4 months, we've disposed of 1,634 tons of refuse. That's an increase over 2015. 2015 was only 1,525 tons. 741 tons of recycling, that's also up, which is a good trend. But overall, we're 7.8% above what we were this time a year ago. My concern is, because the same similar pattern last year, is that we had a really good summer and the refuse was up accordingly. It just could tick up. It seems to be ticking up at about 100 tons a year, every single year. So we've spent already $432,000 for disposal. Sludge is also up. We've produced 952 tons. There was 991 tons for this period for last year. But in comparison to prior years, being going back 2 or 3 years ago, it's up a lot higher. There's just a lot more activity out there. The department is going to be very active in the second quarter. Some things that we're going to be tackling is we're going to, as I said, going to continue to test Tide Mill Creek. We're working with Smutty Nose Brewery. We've given them an administrative order to install additional pre-treatment measures. They're by order intended to be installed in June and fully operational by the end of the year. I would like to say that the staff over there, the owners, have been working with us very diligently, and we appreciate that. Enough said. We also like to express our thanks to the voters for their support and our need to replace some of the plow trucks. The bids are currently out, and they're due on May 19th. It is our intention to have the new trucks outfitted and ready for the fall and winter operations. We're currently putting together our sidewalk replacement bid for Toll Ave. We'll also be replacing sections of the sidewalk right outside this building at Town Hall, and we've got a number of handicap ramp installations planned around town. The Household Hazardous Waste Collection Day is June 4th. Here in our own transfer station, the towns of Newcastle and Hampton Falls have been invited, and their residents will be permitted to have their household hazardous waste accepted by our contractor, which is Care Environmental. They're picking up their own, they're paying for their own individual, the people that show up. We have an agreed upon per unit price, and we've also agreed to share some of the operational costs. based upon the percentage that people show up. We're currently preparing our bid for paving that will occur later this summer. Our intention is to have it all completed prior to school opening so we don't conflict with bus routes. Roads within the bid, and it's in a draft form still being reviewed, or Landing Road, that's that section of road to the west of 101. Old Stage Road, Driftwood Road, Cedarview Lane, Forest Drive, Maplewood Drive, and Watson Lane. We're also putting out a bid for some crack sealing. You know, that helps extend the life of some of these roads. Fred's just got us on a track to complete our budget for next year by July 1st, which is fine, makes sense. And the engineering contract for the reconstruction of the Mill Pond Dam is being reviewed by the legal department. It's our expectation that they'll start this summer with the design and getting the permits going. There was a comment asked earlier with respect to the Brown Ave tide gate. We solicited a contract last fall. It took most of the winter to get the legal verbiage and get us all on the same page. The contract got signed, I think, about 2 weeks ago. And as of communication last week, they had already started on the work. So we expect that a new plate will be installed and the tide gate will be remounted to the head wall, and that will make it functional. It won't totally eliminate the flooding. It will just keep back the king tide floods. That's what it's supposed to do. It was designed in cooperation with representatives from the EPA and U.S. Fish and Wildlife. They want to keep the fish species that lives in that brackish water, they want to keep those alive because they help control the mosquito population in that watershed, and that's why the tide gate is there. Questions with respect to
from the board
on operations?
Jean?
I have no questions. I'm still concerned about that pipe, regardless of what some people seem to believe, but I'm glad that you guys are going to be monitoring it, and you'll let us know if anything's out of the ordinary.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm going to do my best to relay all this information to the public so that they understand what the situation is. I think it's an important one.
Agreed.
Yeah, just in general, what was said in public comment, you guys have already looked at all that stuff. You're well on top of
that. Jennifer's going to go over that.
Okay, then.
Jerry's information comes from the fact that we have an open door policy. He's been down, had, I believe, two meetings with us in the office. And in a separate event, Jennifer went with him to the Church Street site. I appreciate where Mr. Zanoy comes from. He has a background in manufacturing and process, and if you will, maybe risk assessment and evaluation. But this is not putting together a missile system. This is handling raw effluent, and what's at risk in this particular situation is the livelihood and reputation of the beach. So it's they're different ball games, if you will.
Yeah. I have one other question on the refuge, the increase.
Yep.
Is that due to population? Is that, I mean, can you figure why that's happening, or
it's a combination of things. I think it's an uptick in number of year-round residents. It's an uptick in number of building permits. We've definitely put in, you know, 30, 40, 50 houses and any number of condominiums. It's also indicative, if you look at it historically, it's indicative of the economy. If the economy is good, people are buying TVs and throwing away styrofoam and big cardboard boxes. And what we can historically, Mark keeps track of the numbers back through 2009, if you can actually look at the last recession and how it just dipped right off. Mm. So it's a indicator of things are better for consumers.
Right.
And as a result, it shows up in the waste.
Thank you.
Phil?
Great job. Thank you very much. Appreciate it. I know you're gearing up for the summer, and that's right upon us. So keep up the good work. The best to your men and women. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
You mentioned about taking all those trees out. Are you planting new trees?
Haven't quite gotten around to that. I did float the idea through Ms. Martin in the Recreation Department that she stated last year we had really too many benches around town and everybody wanted to have a new bench. I suggested to her that maybe we could divert those people wanting to donate some trees, and especially to like replace the ones that were taken down in the parks. Because when we do take them down, we're also grinding out the stumps, so there'll be area available to replace those. But as yet, I haven't been focusing on replanting trees.
Yeah, because I think it would be nice if there was a time when Hampton had far more trees than they have today. So to just keep taking them out and not putting them in, I don't think is wise.
I would agree.
Yeah. And I think that's a good idea with Diana. And when we are going to be talking about the sidewalks in 2 weeks, I'd like to hear of what your plans, long-term plans for the sidewalks of all of Hampton, not just the ones at the beach. Yep. I'm sure you must have some type of a plan, and I'd like to hear of what it is.
Okay.
A long-range plan. And I hope that someone from your department will be here in two weeks. And I also think that we should have somebody from the school board. They seem to be quite concerned about redesigning the sidewalks around the school that might be happening after the taxpayers voted. And money spent from the town of Hampton on those plans. I'd like to hear about that. And I am interested to hear of what we're going to discuss about replacing the pipes in the marsh. But my thinking is similar to Mr. Zanoy's. I don't think it's a complete emergency, and I'm hoping that we make sure that these are the pipes that are most important in the town of Hampton. I'm looking forward to that discussion. Thank you.
Thank you.
Yeah, I kind of went through it. And one, I had the church force main, and I know you guys, and I was down there when you guys were cutting that pipe and saw what was in the ground. And I'm sorry that I have to disagree with Mr. Zanoy, but I think we have two engineers on our staff that are used to working with sewer treatment plants, sewer treatment lines. Mr. Zanoy may do a very good job at BIE, but he doesn't have any experience with the sewer treatment plant like you do. So we're looking to you for your expertise. I think that's important. Tree removal, I agree with Rick that if we can get with Diana, obviously some of those trees that should be put back shouldn't go in the same places that they were because they had issues there to do it, but maybe we can find some other places or other parks that we can. If we take down a tree, at least replace it. I think that's a good idea.
Yep.
Solid waste, you, as you said, it's up by, the sludge is up by 21%, and you're up by almost 8% in as far as your trash. One of the things you talked about the putting out the bid for the seal cracking. I hope we get to that a little sooner than we did last year.
Okay.
I noticed I was up walking Route 1 before they had the chance to sweep the street. And the plows coming up through had cleared a lot of that out, and I think it just didn't have enough time to seal.
Okay.
And I think if we're doing it, we need to do it a little sooner in the year rather than later. Other than that, I know I asked you to bring up some stuff on the pedestrian lights, but we'll do that at another time. I think we'll work on that sometime. So,
all right.
Mr. Town Manager, do you have anything?
No, he's still got quite a list to go through, Mr. Chairman.
Okay, that's right. That was just his update. I'm sorry.
Right.
So you already talked about the force main. Do you want anything else on that?
Jennifer's got a matrix of the various options that we wanted to go through.
So basically, this was a matrix that was put together to respond to the state's request about what are you guys doing with the schedule? You know, what is going on? What are your next steps? And knowing that there is a lot of talk, well, is it needed? Is it not needed? I think what everybody has to understand is that none of us have a crystal ball. What we're doing is our best engineering, our best thoughts. When this force main failed, we were in quite a dilemma. If it had been the middle of the summer, We would have been in a much different situation than we were. Because the one pipe, everybody's got to remember, there's two pipes through the marsh. One pipe cannot handle the flow during our summer needs. So we have one pipe that's in the ground that is 49 years old. That's the concrete pipe. And another pipe that's in the ground that's 29. It was the 29-year-old pipe that had a failure. It was a rock. Are there other rocks? We don't know. Could there be? Yes, potentially. There could potentially be 200 more of them if every piece of segment of pipe was held up by a piece of rock, if it was used in the construction process versus a sheared off piece of ledge that was referred to earlier. But I don't know that answer. Saying, well, we should be investigating it. There's ways to investigate these pipes, and this is what we've been doing. This is sort of the homework we've had since last time I was here, and this matrix is really trying to put it all together. So I'm gonna go through this fairly quickly because we could spend hours on it, but it's available. I can put it on the website. Any of you also can have it. It was the response back to the state. The first thing was identify the pipe characteristics. Well, how do we know if it's broken? Is it thickness? Are there other holes? Well, the only way that you can do that is through cammering the pipe. So if we're talking about the ductile pipe and cammering that line, this is not as simple as what you see maybe Toby do downtown when he's, you know, looking through a pipe. He jets it clean first. And then he puts the camera in, and the camera goes a few hundred feet, and you get a nice pretty image of the inside of the pipe, and you're done. This is 4,500 feet of pipe. That the cameras are not long enough. There is not equipment that's long enough to be able to do it in one section. You can't go in from one end, or what they call it, the pig launcher on the Church Street pump station side, or the valve pit on the other side. You can't camera the whole line. So what good does it do to camera two-thirds of the line? You still don't have the crystal ball to know what the other third is going to look like. So we went through, and so for doing this investigation...
Can I make a point on that?
Yes, you can.
The line holds 27, one line holds 27,000 gallons of water. We've tried, and we were able to pull out maybe 10,000 to 12,000 gallons of water. That means there's still another 12 to 14,000 gallons of water in there. So you'd literally have to send through like a rubber plug or other mechanism to push all the effluent out of the line. When we asked them, and this is before you videotape inspection, when we told them that the line was that long and it has two 11-degree bends in it, they want us to go out in the marsh and break those two sections open just so that they can clean the line, just so they can videotape it.
And that's exactly where I was headed with this. I don't know if you can see the red and the blue here, but cleaning the pipe is defined as the maximum distance that can be cleaned is 1,500 feet. To clean the entire line, which is required, you'd have to go down, put all those maps out, excavate to the pipe, and then actually break it, intentionally break it. Go in there, give yourself access to be able to clean it. Okay, so yep, you've broken it, you've cleaned it. Well, okay, now we can put the camera in, but we'd have to do that in two spots because you can't get it 1,500 feet. It's not the middle. You wouldn't get back to both sides. So to do the investigation is quite a significant undertaking, and you're purposely breaking pipes that may or may not... You're causing failure. You're causing failure. And let's not forget, one of the big issues we had when we were out there the first time is that cement pipe, the one that's 49 years old, is right there, about 7 feet away. So we risk all over again, damaging what would be the one lifeline left to go investigate what the condition of the ductile iron pipe is. As far as what was referred to as the, was a sonogram, or looking, using techniques, computer techniques and those to try to find rocks and find ledge, that's not going to tell you anything about the condition of your pipe. The pipe is what makes the water get from one side to the other. Also, this is that salt water. It's not, the salt water interferes with a lot of the ultrasonic stuff that is out there. And Jerry did do a fabulous job. He actually dropped off a stack of stuff where he did. He went through it and looked at all these investigative techniques. We use that to help come up with this. I mean, it's been a, you know, we didn't maybe get to connect in the last 2 weeks or so, 3 weeks, but the ideas were there. What can we do to do it? So that pipe investigation, again, it's cleaning the pipe and doing the video inspection. As I said, cleaning the pipe, you've got to break it, you've got to cut it. And then to do the video inspection, you can't do that on the AC line. That's only the ductile iron line. So only the line that's 29 years old can you do the actual ultrasonic stuff because you need the metal to ping it off of. And this is sort of the first step. So to go to something that's a replace in the marsh, I'm sure you've all heard through this process, well, can't you slip line it? Can't you burst it? Like, why are we going to go out and move it all again? Can we use the infrastructures there? Well, all this builds on everybody, every other step. In order to slip line or burst, you have to do video inspection. No one will go in there with their machinery. So again, to do those two options, you first have to clean the pipe, which means breaking the pipe, doing the video inspection. And I do have some of the costs down at the bottom. I mean, you're talking over $500,000 just to do the investigation. Because again, I got to get back out into the marsh. I got to get the equipment out there. You've got to do the pipe repair, and now you're doing it in two locations, plus paying almost $120,000 just for the video of the one ductile iron line. So in this matrix, I sort of went from the inspection. The inspection is what you would need to do the slip lining or the bursting, keeping in mind, again, that if you slip line, you reduce the capacity of the pipe. So that's obviously going to be a problem since I need both pipes to get all the flow from point A to point B in the high flow months. And then, well, if I slip line one, then I have to make another one bigger. So you would have to burst the concrete pipe. The concrete pipe is saddled to timber piers. In the companies we've talked to, they aren't 100% convinced they know exactly how that's going to burst since it's already all restrained to these piers that are in the marsh. So again, you run into a lot of, the word risk has come up, whether it's been here or budget committee meetings and, you know, should we go or not go and what is that risk? Well, we could go with, let's not, you know, replace them. Let's just try to do a slip line. Let's just try to do a fix. The dollars associated with finding out that you can't burst it halfway through the process are going to be phenomenal. And there isn't a dollar amount we can put to that not knowing what the problem will be. So there's a lot of risk in that. So that's sort of the summary of the investigation, the slip lining, the bursting. There's a lot of information here. Again, happy to go through it. But at the end of the day, what are you left with? You're left with two pipes in the marsh that you can't access, that we can't maintain. You know, a long, long time ago, someone put these in the marsh. Well, I'm not quite sure they completely thought about how they were maintaining them. Because if today's technology can't maintain them, I don't know how they were planning on doing it. So I look at it and I go, well, if you do have a failure or we're risking potential failure, and this is the lifeline to the beach, you've all heard it before, between, you know, the parking lots and the revenue created down at Dread and the hotels and sales tax and all the other things that, you know, are part of the economy down at the beach where they flush and they maybe not know where it all goes, but we do. It comes through the Church Street pump station into the treatment plant. That's an extremely high risk to say, well, maybe we should just leave it there and not be able to maintain it in the future and not be able to get out there if there's a failure. There's a failure this summer. It's an automatic $280,000 to run a temporary pipe. And that temporary pipe doesn't install overnight. It's 5 days at a minimum.
Can I just stop you right there, Mr. Chairman? I ask a question.
Okay. This event that occurred this winter.
Yep.
It's July 4th, 2016. What happens to effluent, your capacity to handle it, and operations at the beach, tourists, hotels, motels, and restaurants? What goes on? You get the phone call from the state. The exact same thing has happened. It's a burst pipe.
Mm-hmm.
Either pipe. The 49, the 29. Doesn't matter. What happens?
I call Fred first.
I get a bucket. We go bailing.
We'd shut down the failed line.
Just like we did last time.
We literally would put someone in the Church Street pump station 24/7 to monitor the flow, so that they're there to react. One of the problems is the flow in the beach area cannot continue to come at the Church Street pump station at its normal rate, because if the wet well fills up and we're only pushing away so much at a time, it's going to come out of manholes down Ashworth first. Or that'll be the first place you'll notice it.
What's going to come out of manholes?
Raw effluent. We can, you know, we even looked at, okay, if we bring over a tractor trailer rig, you know, a full-size tanker that you'd see hauling gas down the road, they make them, you know, Mortridge has one for hauling pool water. We start filling that thing with wastewater and run it around the corner and dump it in the plant. It would take, on the biggest day, it would take 80 of those trucks. I calculated that to move all the wastewater would take 147. Okay. If I had one force main.
Chairman, I would like to know, first of all, our jet people are not going to be deciding this. This is going to be decided by the state that they're going to tell you to shut it down, right? So they're the ones we should be asking this. These are all hypothetical, and I hate to hear all this stuff threatening and making it sound like it's all at the beach and blah, blah, blah. This would be a problem no matter where it is. And it's not fair to ask him these questions because he's not the one that would be making these decisions. And these hypothetical scare tactics I find nauseating.
Can I just say this, Mr. Chairman?
And I'm sick of hearing him here.
I'm just asking if this phenomenon did occur.
We need the state here to make these decisions. It would continue to leak in the marsh just like it did probably for months, if not years. And to sit here and make these things like this, I think it's not right. Well, and I don't think it's fair to them either.
Well,
because the state is the one that's going to make these decisions.
The state will make some of the decisions, but obviously our
they'll be making the decisions of when we have to close those pipes because they were leaking for months, if not years.
Well, I am not an engineer,
and I have no problem with fixing them. But to come up with these hypothetical situations, I think is ridiculous.
Well, that's your opinion. I would like to know that we do have the capability.
And then to keep blaming it on the beach, I think is absolutely wrong.
I don't think anybody
has seen nothing like this in all the years I've been here.
I don't think anybody is blaming this on the beach. It is a fact of life. And that's the life type.
To sit here and say we're going to close the beach is ridiculous.
Ever said that.
If there's going to be a nuclear holocaust, maybe.
Well, nobody said that we're going to close the beach. They were just trying
to... Well, then let's just wait. Let's talk about what we have, facts.
And I think that's what they were doing. They were trying to explain...
making up, what are we going to do if all of a sudden we're not the ones that are going to decide the beach, there's a problem. I've sat here while we were told that this plant could handle all the development that's here today and much more that's yet to come. So this is wrong to come up with these hypothetical situations. And it's not fair to either of you.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's your opinion, and you have the right to that. I also think that Mr. Bean asked a question, and he asked a very valid question.
They're not going to ones making that decision. And that's what I'm bringing up.
Well, they may not be making some of the decisions, but they're going to make a lot of them.
We instantly shut the pipe.
Well, why didn't you close it before the months or years that it was already leaking? When Mr. Welch sat here and told us that we thought someone was dumping a honey wagon up in the Taylor River, why wasn't something done then?
The minute we knew that it was coming out of Tide Mill Creek, that's when it got shut down.
And that's what's going to happen the next time.
Okay, I agree.
We're not going to be taking trucks down there, 80 of them, and I think this is ridiculous to come up with saying things like this. Well, it's a scare tactic that's not going to work with the voters.
Well, I think that you're right. We're not going to shut it down until we do know it's there. But if we had to shut that pipe down in the summer, like had happened, we do have to have a plan.
Well, we'd have to have an emergency meeting of this board,
right,
to grant authority to enter into the contract for the emergency bypass pumping because of the quantity of money that it would take, or not, and the authority to shut down the beach doesn't rest with, it's a health issue, so it doesn't rest with my jurisdiction, it rests with the code enforcement officer, or whoever the designated health officer is. That's really where it lies.
But I think what Mr. Bean was looking at was, do you have a plan
that if in fact we do have another,
we have contacts and contracts for emergency moving of wastewater.
And we had those before too.
Right, and we have a contract for the bypass pumping, the bypass line which would be laid on all parallel to 101, right back to the plant.
And I'd like to also say that I find it impossible that the people put those pipes in and didn't have a second plan of what to do. When every time I get in my car, I have a second plan of what's going to happen in case something gets in my way. And I can't believe all of these different boards didn't have a plan. It may not be a plan that's valid today, but I'm sure they had a plan. That's why they put the second pipe in, number one. And I'm not saying I know anything, and I don't want to be the one to make these decisions, but I don't want to be getting these answers. What happens if Martians come here tomorrow?
I don't care about what Martians come tomorrow.
Well, you know what? I don't either, because they're not coming.
Well, I don't have that crystal ball. I just want to make sure that we have a plan, and I know you have updated it,
right?
Because before it was never discussed about, I believe, in that other plan about running a separate line.
And that's, the state has asked the same thing. They want to make sure that we have operational procedures in place, and we do.
And they haven't told us to do anything. Anything they've told us to do, we did, and that's what our plan is. That's what we're going to do the next time, too.
We've also done what the state has asked, correct?
Correct.
We always do.
Make sure we have a plan in place. Something that we may have had some, but not as good as the plan we have now.
Correct.
Thank you.
Well, I don't know if I want to go now. Just saying. No, to continue on, again, this was done to do a step-by-step and to also let everybody understand the alternatives, because you've heard all of it. You've heard the slip line and the first thing. What about directional drilling? What about leaving it where it is? So this is the process for these types of replacement. And that's why this was put together, to show what would need to be done to do these type of replacements. So at the end of the day, we talked about the money that it would cost to investigate, to find out if there was a hole in the pipe, the investigation part. The fact that if you slip line or you burst, you lose capacity and you gain capacity, but there's no guarantee and a lot of risk. I'm sure you've heard people say, well, can you directionally drill it? That's what the gas companies use, you know, to push it through. Again, what you have here is that you'd be directionally drilling two force mains, and you pay by the foot. So you're in turn paying double. When you look at the cost, that's actually more expensive than to put it in the land route. So these are, again, comparisons when you're looking at what the options are. And then the last part, and again, I'm going to say, and from the engineer perspective, having them in a marsh is a problem. I didn't put them there. In fact, I'm not quite sure I knew they were there before I took this job.
You weren't even born when they were put so, there. So, you know.
But I look at it, but I also know what I dealt with when we had to go deal with something. And it was not easy. So when you look at the dollars spent and what you gain rerouting these pipes into Route 101, where they're inland, where they're accessible, where they can be redesigned to have access ports, no future breaking of the pipe to clean it or to investigate what's going on, this was the last option that's here, which is the Route 101 replacement. And that came in $1 million cheaper than the in-marsh replacement for the directional drilling. It was more money than the combo of the slip line and the burst, but the slip line and burst didn't give you an outcome that, to me, is why would you spend all that money if you're still going to be left with a huge problem? And no maintenance and no access are large problems. So that's the whole chart in a nutshell. I tried.
No, that's good. We sent this on to the state. They asked for it, I believe, 3 weeks ago. Huh? And it got real quiet after we sent it up. So curiosity kills the cat. I first called just to say, hey, did you get it? Do you have any questions? Oh, yeah, we got it. No, we don't have any questions. So then the second time I called, I was just about ready to call you. Said, okay. What's the board going to do? I said, we're presenting, you were on vacation, they said, so we're presenting this matrix that they received tonight to get input from you as to how do you want to proceed with the design contract? Do you, in the March meeting, do you want to proceed with the construction cost, a preliminary bid in the March meeting? I explained to her, she thought it was very insightful to get Fred's flow chart of how what it takes to get through for a special town meeting. She realizes, we all do now, that that can't happen tomorrow or the next week, and literally doesn't happen till March. So their response is going to be based upon whatever your response is tonight. If your response is we're moving forward with some solution, that's what I'm going to communicate to them. If your response is we're going to hold tight, that's what I'll relate to them. So it kind of comes back to what we'd like to do as a board. What would I like to do is probably the next question. I'd at least like to proceed forward with the design and engineering contract so that we could determine a factual price to bring forward to the voters. That's what I would like to do.
In or out of the marsh?
Out of the marsh. Mm-hmm. So that I can... The other thing is, and Fred pointed out to me, are you planning for expansion? Because at the back of, I think, yeah, what I gave you, this is, and this is only because Mike Carl gave it to me today when I asked him for sludge numbers, but that's your long-term growth, if you will, at the wastewater treatment plant, which given the rate of rebuild and expansion at the beach, which I fully support, can only go up. It won't go down. So, so we need to kind of move forward. And Fred, in discussing warrant articles and putting together the CIP, we've agreed to ask for the potential to put in up to three pipes that give us future capacity. But right now, the number that we presented was two 18-inch pipes along Route 101, in either with a sleeve under Tide Mill Creek, or I'd rather have a bridge over that I could eventually turn into a footbridge or a bike path to get people off of the shoulder of Route 101. But that's something that will be worked out in the design process because it'll be a function of cost.
I think we want to hear from Fred first, see if he's got anything he wants to add to this before we go back to the board.
Well, I think that the department has summed it. We need a course of action if the board wishes to take a course of action. And quite frankly, at least what I've seen from the state, and Public Works has been the one interfacing directly with them because of operational concerns. What I've seen from the state is panic because they don't know what to do. We started out with this process, and they said, well, the only two things we can do is to go to a special meeting or to go to the annual meeting. And we figured out the matrix to go to the special meeting, which would end up 1 week before the annual. So that solved that problem. And they said, okay, we got to wait till March, regardless of what happens. So we cross our fingers and hope everything is fine and everything runs along fine. If we get to March, they would like to see us replace those mains and get them out of the marsh. That's the state's unstated position. When you talk to them, it's almost like hearing fear in a voice. The uncertainty that's involved in it. No one knows if those pipes are going to last for another 100 years or whether they're going to fail in 2 hours. Just no one knows. The only way to ensure, 100% ensure, that you have some control over what's going on is to move them out of the marsh. That's an expensive proposition, and you have to think about that carefully before you make a decision. Leaving them in the marsh means you have literally no options. You can't maintain them. You can't inspect them. You can't figure out what's underneath them, which is the problem in this particular case and what happened. Now, I've worked too many years in public works construction to know that if an idiot places a stone like this underneath a pipe for bedding, he's probably going to do it again. So there's probably more of them out there. I don't think there's 200, but there only needs to be one more to really make a real mess. we're going to end up, and there's no question in my mind about this either, we're going to end up with a huge fine from the EPA and the state if that happens. They've already told us point blank that that's going to happen. We'll wait to see what really does happen, but I don't think it's going to burst. I don't think it's going to do that, but I agree with the Public Works. We have no way to maintain it, and we have no way to clean it. We looked at what was in the pipe that burst that had the hole in it, and a lot of the gravel material, the bedding material, and so forth was sucked right down that pipe. You could see it when they had the pipe open. If we were to so-called pig the pipe, that is to put a device in that would sweep all the way to the other end and clean it out, we'd probably get to the low point in the pipe, and that'd be it. The pipe would shut off forever because all that stuff would just congeal right down there at the low point. So cleaning is out without actually physically cutting the pipe into many, many segments in order to get rid of that material that's in there so it won't plug. And it's going to be more expensive than replacing the pipe. You don't have a lot of options, unfortunately. You need to take the best one you have, and I think the best one you have is to replace the pipes. Then you at least know, you know what you got. When you replace them, that's a different issue. But I think that's the best option you have.
All right. We've heard this side. I'd like to hear from this side before we get around, but I know you got some questions, right?
Well, stemming off of what Fred said, the state is scared because this is not the only place this is happening. I've actually joined a company. It's called Water Innovations Alliance. Water infrastructure all over this country, from California to New York, is rotting, whatever the case may be, because people took shortcuts or whatever it was 50, 60 years ago. So I think to just let those pipes continue under the marsh is not going to ensure the sustainability of the town of Hampton, which is pretty much the main reason why I'm doing this job right now. Because in 20, 30 years, something might not happen this summer. So, you know, we can have a plan in place and hopefully we don't need to use it, but having waste pipes 7 feet under a marsh doesn't make sense. It shouldn't have made sense 40 years ago. And the fact that this happened could have been luck for us because, like you said, if it happened in July or whenever, if it did or didn't happen, but would you just let them sit there and just make sure that we stay lucky for an inevitable amount of time? Doesn't sound too smart to me. So I think the state sounds like they sort of want us to make the decision on this one. And I think we should think hard and make a decision on it because it's water. And I mean, you can't really mess around. You don't have water, you're not going to have anything. So.
Yeah, you've done a great job, a really good presentation. You've done a great job on figuring out what needs to be done. And I don't think it's scare tactics to talk about situations, because they are real situations and they really could happen. And I really have to disagree that 20, 30, 40, 50 years ago, people didn't have an extra plan. They didn't. They just did things. I mean, I can remember I've been sailing in Boston Harbor since the 1970s. And in the early 80s, if you fell in, when you get out, the first place you'd go was the hospital. It was so dirty. And now it's clean as anything because somebody came up with a plan and said, we got to do something about this. And they did Deer Island sewage treatment plant there and sent it 7 miles out. So I think this is all realistic. I agree 100%. Putting it under the marsh was stupid. They did it. We've got to do something to correct it to make sure that we maintain quality water in Hampton and make sure we maintain the marsh and the wetlands there. I think we need to.
Yeah, I would like to say that I'm not even against this. I just am against these scare tactics that I've never heard happen, like what's happening here and what I've heard here recently. I think it's totally wrong. And I disagree with what you said about the state said this or that. They just told us the state has said nothing. And trust me, when the state has something to say, they do not hold back. Mr. Welch knows that. They speak up and they say. They're not saying anything.
There's no state speaking up on this right now.
Well, because there's nothing to they don't feel that they have to. That's exactly my point. When we've had other times when they've had to speak up, they speak up. And I would like to know what other towns get these fines. Again, I'm not against doing it. What I would like to hear both of these people say is that this is the number one priority for the town of Hampton. Yeah, pipes could break anywhere, all over the town. We can't worry about every little pipe that's going to break. Do we have any information that other pipes are going to break that might be more of an issue? Because those are the ones I'd like to see replaced also. I just don't think that this needs to be dealt with in such a way that we're threatening and saying these inflammatory things. I think it's totally wrong, and I'm not against. I will vote for whatever. I think we need to look and see what these costs are. I like your idea. There's something new we heard here tonight about there might be the possibility of three pipes. And I'd like to see what those money, how the money cost fits in there. I am not against this at all. I'm just against it the way that it's been presented. And, you know, there was a lot of information to gather here. And that's what we've been doing. We're doing it in a good way. We should be doing it in a way that we're looking of ways to save the town money. Mm-hmm. I am not against this. But I'm just saying, I do know from sitting on this board for 12 years that when the state has something to say, they say it. And they've not said it.
Mr. Chairman, may I have the floor?
Yes.
Thank you. Do you have a cost for a study that could be made as a motion tonight in terms of the cost for an option for the effluent pipes to run along Route 1 as you described?
We have a design of a contract that we got from Wright Pierce for the design, permitting everything right to bid, and I didn't bring it with me tonight. I did forward a copy to the manager's office. I believe it's at, I want to say $219,000, but that takes us all the way through construction.
Okay. And in terms of a bid process, that's one company that you have sent that out?
Right. The logic behind that was that Wright Pierce designed our Church Street pump station. And in the process of putting in the force mains, if the pumps needed to get upgraded or resized or refitted, if you will, to match these force mains, that they were the logical choice to do it. When you're faced with an emergency, I'd like not to change horses or wagon teams, if you will, because a lot of the money that we would end up spending with another engineering team would be to get them up to speed, so to speak. I don't think in this situation it's wise to change teams.
I understand that, and I would be interested in satisfying, given that caveat, our compliance with the bidding process and understanding the exigency of this problem. I haven't heard any scare tactics tonight. I've heard people talking factually about engineering. I heard people talking about actual eruptions of a pipe, and we're addressing those. And I would be interested, Mr. Chairman, on our very next meeting with an interim communication with the state that we are pursuing along those lines. And I'm happy to make a motion, or perhaps another board member can, but to put this on the agenda for our very next meeting. And to bring this up with the Wright Pierce proposal, address our compliance with bid specifications and competitive bidding, and to address this issue.
I'd like to make the one statement. I don't care what the state says.
I don't either.
It's our responsibility to maintain the marsh and the ocean and the water in Hampton. It's the Board of Selectmen's responsibility. So the state can say whatever they want to. I mean, they could force us to do something, but I think we need to take, our own action.
State's not going to force you to do anything as long as the board makes a decision. If the board makes a decision to do nothing, that's a decision, okay? And the state will back that to a certain degree. They'll issue warnings and so on and so forth if something happens, but they'll back it. They're not in the business of running this wastewater treatment plant. The Board of Selectmen is, and the town is. And that's pretty much the state's position. Only if something disastrous happens, like we have another break and it floods the marsh or something, then they'll step in and they'll order you to do something. They were very cooperative with us this time. They didn't give us any direct orders other than to fix it and to make sure we came up with a plan on how we're going to continue to maintain it and test it. and we followed those instructions. So they were very forceful when they said there is a fine procedure, and I believe we handed out some fine summonses from EPA earlier to other cities and towns. They're not looking to do that because it's not in their best interest to do it. If they find us a few hundred thousand dollars, that's a few hundred thousand dollars we can't use to fix the line. They know that. And they're just not going to do that unless they absolutely positively are forced to do it by higher authority. That isn't going to happen. It might be a minor fine at the very best. Slap your hand and say, don't do it again. Give us a couple hundred dollars or something. Maybe a couple of thousand dollars, but that's nothing. I think you need to make a decision. I believe that the public works engineers are correct. That we need to, in fact, proceed to find out what it's going to cost to replace it. We have, in fact, two lines in town that are in danger. One's on Lafayette Road, and one is down here in the marsh. And they need to actually, I think they actually need to look at both of those lines, and they need to come back to this board with the information on what it's going to cost to replace
it. So I'll make that motion. And just like, that's what I've always thought they should be. But I just haven't really liked the way so much of this has been presented here at this board, talking about closing down the beach and this and that. I've been here too long to know that there are other answers.
I'll second that motion.
I will make that motion.
And what is the motion? Specifically, what is the motion?
To obtain bid specifications, costs, to replace the sewer line running across the marsh, both lines, and perhaps with a third. A third is an option. And to replace the line on Lafayette Road that runs from High Street to Toll Avenue, which is broken.
And Mr. Griffin, would that be
external from the marsh? I'm going to discuss it after someone seconds it.
I think Jim seconded it.
Yeah, he did.
And my question is this is for the external along Route 101?
Correct.
In Lafayette Road.
Whatever he recommends. And I just hope that this is our top priority. That's all I have ever asked, that this is our top priority. Because if we have something else that's out there, that should be brought up at this time also.
Nothing else to my knowledge.
Because we can sit around and wait for all the pipes to break. But I think we have better things to do.
I could do that. You're right. So we have better things to do.
We have a motion and a second. All those in favor? I'd just like to say I haven't heard anybody here threaten to close the beach tonight. I have not heard that one.
You haven't.
What about the 80 pipes, the 80 things to pick up affluent at the pump station?
That's
what I call a threat.
No, I don't call
it
a threat.
Well, then, that's good that you don't, but I do.
I call that good planning. And then we need to make sure we have good planning in case
something
like this.
And we do have good planning, and that's why this hasn't happened before.
We do now, and people have heard what had happened.
We've discussed it. We had a motion. We had a vote. Let's move on.
That's right. Thank you.
That's all that I've asked.
Okay.
Thank you. Household hazardous waste.
Plan for June 4th. We do have a contract signed with Care Environmental. They're the same company that the 53B district used last year. I did not get three prices. It's partially because it's less than $15,000 on the contract. It'll probably, our cost will be somewhere around $8,000. But secondly, this is a company that we had experience with. They've done it for the 53B district, which we were a member of for the last several years. And probably a high confidence in them that we wouldn't have an issue on that particular day. The base contract is $500 to just get them here, and then it's $38 a car, and we typically have about 170 to 180 cars, so we kind of know what our dollar amount is going to be. But it really is dependent on is it good weather that day or bad weather. I mean, I'm sure if it's raining and misting out, a lot of people will stay away, but if it's dry and sunny, then
we didn't have one of those last year, correct?
We did. We had one last year. I had to run it. It was May. I think it was rounds.
Last year, the year we had the problem, was that the year before? The
year before.
Okay. And that's all
that's been
addressed and taken care of?
Yeah. So we got that vetted, and that is not going to be the problem. Not a problem at all.
And do we need a motion for this?
I think you do.
All right. So does anybody want to make a motion?
with.
I'll motion it.
Okay, motion to sponsor the hazardous waste along with Newcastle
and Hampton Falls.
Hampton Falls.
And I think what you're doing is you're waiving the personnel policy, purchasing policy, to a degree. This doesn't come to the bid threshold, and it doesn't come to the $15,000 threshold where you have to have multiple bids or multiple costs. This comes to an established current vendor that we've used for at least all the years I've been here, and before that, that has done the household hazardous waste day. So.
Okay, so we have a motion and second. All those in favor?
And the state's paying for us.
Unanimous. Okay. The JOP with DRED.
It came back. Fred forwarded it on to me. It didn't look like there were any substantial changes at all, except for they wanted coated bags, yellow bags. We pointed out to them we've already ordered the bags. We already had the bags in. Fred, I believe, communicated that back to Dred that they wouldn't be coated, whatever that means. But other than that, it's the same agreement that we had in the previous year, and it seemed to work well.
Any discussion from the board?
You're happy with it?
Yeah.
So moved. There were two things that needed to be changed within the agreement that the state sent us. Every year they have in their computers, they just generate it and send it to us. One was to eliminate the color-coded bags, just colored bags, which we've used every year. And I did talk to the person in charge of the Seacoast region who called for the office, and he said not a problem. The other thing was that we wanted to make sure that when they do have access through Bicentennial Park, where the driveway is, which is all the way to the north end of the park, that in fact they use that from Route 1A, because the last time they used it, they walked the equipment right straight across our paved area and right straight across the beach area and the park, the area in Bicentennial Park, and dug it up in doing that. So we put in there they have to use the driveway access as opposed to anything else to get access to the shorefront. They've agreed to both of those things as long as they're okay with the board.
I think that's kind of a special thing because they were working on the wall there at the time and stuff like that.
They weren't. It was their vendor. It wasn't them.
Right.
Yeah, we just wanted to make sure that everybody understood where we were.
Okay, so do we have a motion?
I'll make that motion.
Motion.
That we accept the JOP.
I'll second it.
Second. All those in favor? Unanimous. Okay, we have the approval of sewer disconnection and connection permits and procedures.
This was more me getting my hands dirty and going through what we currently have for sewer connection and disconnection permits, there being we didn't have a sewer disconnection permit. And what was happening is it was causing quite some confusion, because what would happen is a contractor would come in, say, well, I need the inspection because I'm disconnecting, because I'm taking down the house, I'm doing a remodel, doing something. And 6-7 months down the road, coming back and actually getting the permit to reconnect it, and you know, then having to dig out the files, where were the ties, exactly what was happening, and where we have the sewer access fee that goes along with it. Things are just getting very muddled. This is really an exercise in organization and being very clear with the contractors and the town people that what we're looking to do is that if you are going to do a disconnect, you come get a disconnect permit. It's just a flat $50 fee. That's the only new part. And that's for the time we still do tie cards, that still put the plans together, and for our sewer and drain guys to go out and actually do an inspection. When you're ready for the connection, albeit 3 days, 3 months, whatever later, you come in and you fill out the connection. Are you a new user? Are you replacing something in kind because you had a failure? Are you making a betterment to the system? And it's all spelled out exactly what each category is, and the same $300 connection fee would apply. That's it. We wrote up a standard operating procedure to go with it, so that in the event that we all get hit by a bus and someone had to issue a sewer connection or disconnection permit, someone could come read how it should be done, and that's also part of the packet.
Make a motion that we accept the new procedure.
Is there a second?
Second.
All those in favor? Okay. Last one is the waiver of the purchasing policy, 718-4 subsection B2 and 718-16 for the High Street signal repair, single source, less than 3 quotes.
So this is related to the High Street drainage improvement project. Related and yet different, and why I'm bringing it here. When we were doing the drainage project, there was one loop, and if you're not familiar, the loops are sort of these conductive things that when you drive over them, they help change the cycling of the lights. If you've been down lately, you'll notice you'll be sitting there. Nobody else is going in any direction, but you're still sitting. Well, it's because it's not detecting. One loop was damaged as part of the project. In the investigation of, like, why is this not working, we had electric light come out there. They work with the fire department with Justin Cutting, and they, very responsive, came down and figured out that 6 of the loops are not working. They're not all from the project, but the things are not working, and they're not reading back to the cabinet. That's how the whole system runs. So in doing all this and talking with them, it's expensive to keep cutting these loops in. It cuts the pavement. You have to maintain them. Looking at, well, what are other intersections doing? When you build a new intersection these days, what do you do? And this camera system is really it. I say the 360 fisheye. The camera's not to scare anybody. It doesn't record. It's about detection. It can detect the cars, it can detect bicyclists, and it can detect the pedestrians, and the whole system would be interconnected from the one camera that would read back to our existing cabinet, and all the lights would get back to the normal cycle that we're used to doing instead of the long wait process while we're there. We did go to Electric Light for the work. Again, extremely responsive over time. My understanding is we did also reach out to East Coast over a week and a half ago, and still nothing. I mean, it just goes to show that we reach out to Electric Light and we have the quote the next day. The total purchase price of the camera system and to get it installed is $17,880. We do have the money for the repair of the loops that we were going to do and the additional funding to do it. I think it's important to note, it's not Electric Light that's making this money. Their part of it is $2,000. It's the actual equipment that costs money. And reading through with this grid smart fisheye system, this really seems to be the way to go, not just to fix our current situation, but to keep consistent with technology and know that we can have something better out there.
There are 9 loops in that light. And typically, we replace 2 or 3 of those a year.
Mm-hmm.
And I know that because I used to work on those. So by going to the camera, it's not something that's in the ground that has to deal with a frost heave or getting dug up. It's something that has to, it sits above and looks at it. It's not taking pictures, as she said. It is just showing that there is somebody there.
It's a motion detector.
It's a motion detector, mm-hmm. Correct. And we use a company called the Electric Light Company. That's not Unitil. This is a company that makes their living doing traffic signals. There are basically 2 companies that are in the area. There is East Coast Signal, and there's the Electric Light Company. And I talked to Justin the other day on this, and he had reached out to East Coast to get them, and they had not returned any, got back to us yet. Our signals are maintained by the Electric Light Company. I know that our fire alarm crew used to be fire alarm crew, now it's the light company crew, or the traffic signal crew, was out repairing the lights at Hannaford's because one of them got damaged by a vehicle. They could do that type of stuff. They can't do this camera type of stuff. It is specialized, too. I also know that while they were there, they found that one of the pedestals had been hit. They called the Electric Light Company at 10 o'clock in the morning, and by 2 o'clock in the afternoon, Electric Light Company had been down here and repaired that. We get a very good response from these people. They do an excellent job working on our lights. We have a good working relationship, and we have back at least 11 years ago, because that's when I was doing them. So I understand what you're saying. There's basically two people that do it. One hasn't got back to us to even talk about it. And probably the reason they haven't got back to us is it is such a small amount of labor. Mm-hmm. And they would have... The electric light company already knows our whole system. For somebody to come down and try to look at it, they're going to have to send somebody down, look at it to give us a price, and get back to us. And it's just, it's not feasible. So I, for one, have no problem with going to the electric light company. So is there a motion?
I'll motion it.
Second.
Second. All those in favor? Go ahead.
Discussion. I'm
go
just
ahead.
Worried discussion. About the whole waiver on the purchasing.
Okay, go ahead.
So you went out to two, right?
Mm-hmm.
Because there are only two that do it.
Pretty much.
And one came back.
Correct.
The other didn't.
Correct.
So we could sit here and rebid and have the same process go again, probably.
And from my experience, that is exactly what has happened in the past.
And then we rebid again, and the same thing had happened. Yeah. Right. Okay.
And we still have a set of lights downtown that are still not cycling correctly and holding traffic.
Terrible.
And, you know, that's the problem. Maybe there needs to be a different...
Purchasing policy,
because this has been the problem. And because this was the problem before, that's why we have... It's exactly the same as it was before. That's why we have the purchasing policy that was made up.
Right.
So it's not like, you know, here we have two in a row now. We've avoided the purchasing policy. And there are reasons. I've heard from several people this week about sitting there waiting at the light.
Absolutely.
I know that Rusty, you used to
maintain
the lights. I've seen you up there. But, you know, this is precisely the problem. There's going to be people like Mr. Silberdeck and all his followers are going to question this because it keeps happening over and over again. And the purchasing policy that we have today was made because this is what was happening. So what's not right about it?
We don't have people who want to bid for the town. In some cases...
So can't the policy reflect that?
Yes, sir, it can if the board wishes to amend it.
Maybe we need to change it.
Why don't we bring a proposal?
This is exactly the same policy.
Right.
This is the same problem that made it happen before.
That's correct.
And have given all these people have all this ammunition to come up and take pop shots at us every week.
Would the board like us to bring in proposed amendments that may address this issue?
I think that's something we should discuss.
I think it's a good idea when we bring it up.
Let's discuss it under old business tonight.
Okay.
Discuss it tonight under old business?
Yeah, sure.
It's
a simple answer.
Okay, that's good. Very good. Well, we have a motion on the floor right now. We have a motion and seconded. All those in favor? Unanimous. Thank you.
One more for Public Works.
One more for Public Works.
We have before you a bid recommendation for purchasing aggregates, crushed sand, crushed stone, pure sand, things of that nature. All earth products, we advertised, we went out to bid, we posted it, we got back two bidders.
Hmm.
I'm sure there's people with gravel pits 50, 60, and 70 miles away, but when they look at the hauling costs to get that product here, because we asked for it, the cost delivered it to the yard, they'd lose money, and I think they know that. But we did go through the process of bidding, but we only have two.
Do we know how many we sent it to?
I don't know that offhand. I know...
it's not just sent, though, and I think that's important for everybody to know when we do bids, at least since I've been there. The process that we do is that, yes, there is a list because there's people have shown interest, people have called, but it's not an exclusive list. It's always posted on our website. The DPW page has been modified and edited so you can easily, in two clicks, get to our bids, find the bid tabs, see any addendums that are posted, and they're all put right there. So, for example, if you were in the aggregate business and it was your job to do sales, you customarily would be looking on every surrounding town's website, not looking for an invitation personally hand-delivered to the door,
Something like this, for lack of better words.
So it's been out there. There have been others, and it's been on our website.
How long has it been out there?
This one went out, 2 months ago.
Yeah.
I mean, I think it was out. We try to keep them out to bid 3 to 4 weeks. So I want to say this one was 3 to 4 weeks in that. I mean, I can get a bigger answer.
I just think so long as we can show that we've done everything we can to get people to bid, again, this gets back to our bidding policy, that we've done our due diligence in getting people the ability to bid. It's like the old saying, you can bring a horse to water, but you can't make him drink. And so so long as we can show that we've done that, mm-hmm. I have no problem with it. So we have a motion on this one. What do we...
We accepted bids on the 28th. This particular bid was sent back to us on the 14th.
So that was 2 weeks?
The 14th.
That was a month ago.
Yeah.
Almost right. A month ago.
Yeah.
I make the motion we accepted.
So it's been out there at least a month. If they got it for a month, it's been out there for at least a month. So I have a motion by Jim. Do I have a second? Seconded by Phil.
And I just want to discuss it again. I mean, okay, here's the third one tonight. So this is something that we have to take a look at.
Yep.
Are the bids being put out in the proper manner that everyone else puts them? You know, so the definition of insanity is continue to do the same thing over and over and over again.
Right, that's right.
So this is something that we need to discuss.
I agree.
Okay, so we have a motion and a second. All those in favor? Unanimous.
Not a pour salt on a... Furthers. We passed over a ward of purchase policy for the sewer lateral video camera.
Right.
There again, less than three quotes.
Jeez.
I have to explain this one a little more in that years ago, I'm sure under a bidding process, you bid out for a video camera. This is the video camera that the sewer and drain division uses. It's a camera that looks like a long tube with a fisheye on it. It's actually got wheels on the side. And they literally drive it with a joystick down the sewer main. This is a part or parts to that particular camera that allows us to actually turn the eye and look up the laterals to inspect those. The reason why there's less than three quotes is you have to match the equipment that you have in what you've already invested in, i.e. in the cable, in the camera itself. As you can imagine, some of these vendors don't make some of their parts interchangeable with other people because they want you to use their parts. It's like a year ago, we ordered bigger wheels for the thing so that it could ride in a bigger pipe and also get above any residual water that would be in the bottom. It was the same situation. They are sole source.
I was just going to say that right. It's not the lack of three bids. It's the fact that it's a sole source because it's already a piece of equipment.
Right.
It's like putting Chevy wheels on a...
And how much is it?
Ford.
I gave the paperwork to... I'm going off the agenda.
$4,013.
Thank you.
So that's under the bid policy anyway.
Right.
But yes. Under the
when we do discuss our under old business, we have to consider about the lack of bids and the matching equipment
right.
as being two main obstacles.
Right.
That's, I make that's the motion. We accept this.
True. So I have a motion.
I'll second it.
Second. All those in favor? Unanimous.
Thank you. That's all we had. We're all that's on the agenda.
That's it.
You don't want to hang around a little longer?
I might catch it on TV.
Yeah.
I might catch it on TV.
They'll be running now.
On the reruns.
No, actually, we do. A lot of times watch
it.
The office. Thank you, folks.
Great job. Thank you. Thank you. Good job. Next, we have Jamie Ayotte, the fire chief, along with Deputy Bill Kennedy.
Mr. Chair, I know you know that name.
Bill Kennedy?
Yeah. So, first of all, thank you very much for allowing us to speak with you again this evening. And congratulations, and we welcome you to our first meeting together.
Thank you.
I'd like to thank you for this opportunity, and then I'd like to take a moment to recognize the efforts of the Hampton Firefighters, Local 2664, and the Hampton Fire Supervisors, Local 3017. They've established a 501c3 corporation and can more effectively work as a charitable organization, and that will come into play in just a moment. They've worked tirelessly to support firefighter paramedic Kyle Jameson and his family. Through fundraising, meal preparation, care packages, and child care, the firefighters and their families have been an incredible foundation of strength. Team Jameson has shown what being a team is really all about. I'd also like to thank the board for their support and also the community as a whole. The town of Hampton has certainly shown their support through many fundraisers that have taken place. We look forward to Kyle's full recovery and his return to Hampton. For now, we continue to keep him and his family in our thoughts and prayers as he battles leukemia like a warrior and a true champion. And tonight, through Facebook, we had a small bright tone to the messages that are coming out, so we're all thankful for that. A lot has changed since our last visit, Mr. Chair. We've been working diligently to complete a long list of tasks. I'm pleased to report that the town of Hampton has received her new engine pumper. Engine 4 was delivered on April 28th, and as you know, this pumper was granted to by the town of Hampton voters through a warrant article in 2015. Engine 4 was designed to go into service at the Beach Fire Station, replacing a 1988 engine E1 pumper that served for over 28 years. We've scheduled training for all the groups and are working to put the last items in place before she goes into service. We hope to see our new ambulance delivered next week for the purpose of replacing A1, which was purchased in 2006. A1 left Hampton after bringing countless patients to the hospital and driving 124,086 miles. The purchase of the new ambulance occurs from the Emergency Medical Services Fund 27, which is created specifically with this purpose in mind, and no additional tax revenue was used for this purchase. We've completed the work on upgrading the circuits connecting the voter sites, which I had described to you previously about similar to radio antennas. These FDDA circuits are a four-wire balance circuit that replaces the old two-wire system that was once used by Alexander Graham Bell. The clarity is noticeable, and we will have fewer drop messages and can now understand each other when using the radios. We've ordered six sets of gear, fire turnout gear, as part of a program replacement. And this program replacement was to replace gear that was purchased by Grant in 2009. Deputy Kennedy worked to ensure that the oldest and most worn sets were replaced first. We expect the delivery of a new air refilling station in the next 2 to 3 weeks. This device will be used to refill our SCBA bottles. It will replace a 1987 unit that was given to Hampton Fire Rescue by the SECO's Chief Fire Officers Organization in the mid-90s. We expect the Scott Revolve air system to be in service for many years to come. In March, our fire alarm operator, Bill Ford, resigned his position as a result of an ongoing medical condition. We certainly wish him all the best in his future endeavors and can't state strongly enough that he will always be a member of the family of the fire department. This vacancy created caused Hampton Fire Rescue to hold an open exam and in order to fill a position. We've conducted a written exam and an oral board and have selected the top scorer for this position. Mrs. Carissa Kerouac, currently serving as a Hampton police dispatcher, has been offered and accepted the position. She'll be sworn into the department in the next 2 weeks, and she'll be assigned to Group 4 following the training period. And with your indulgence, I'll ask to swear her in front of the Board of Selectmen. I am pleased to report that every group has been working diligently to train their probationary firefighters. By all accounts, they are a good fit. They work hard, they're very engaged in their own learning process, and we're glad to have them aboard. They have been working hard, too, because Hampton Fire Rescue continues to see an ever-increasing volume of work, no different than DPW. We have been seeing an increase in calls for service, and in 2016 year-to-date, we have responded to 600, and this is at noontime, the number's gone up since, 696 fire calls today, up to today. On the ambulance side, we've had 784 patient contacts. And how does this compare to previous years? In 2013, year-to-date, we saw 575 calls for service, for fire calls. In 2014, it was 614. In 2015, it was 742. And as of today, 696. What we're seeing over time is a 7% increase, a 17.5% increase, and a 6.5% decrease. When we researched it, we found that much of the discrepancy in the number to get us to 17.5 and the difference, it's still an upward trend. But last winter, the winter of 2015, as we can all recall, caused us to be out straight when it came to emergency calls, fireside. Whether it was car accidents or other problems in the home, carbon monoxide, we certainly had to go to do more calls because of that winter. However, We see this as a trend that continues, and I'll get to that in just a moment. On the emergency medical side, in 2013, we saw 598 patient contacts. 2014, 679. 2015, 736. And as of today, 784. So what we're seeing is a 12%, 8%, and 7% increase. What does this all mean? Well, in 3 years' time, we've seen an approximate growth of 17.5% in the volume of fire calls. The growth pattern has adjusted for the spike in calls from the hard winter we had in 2015, demonstrates approximately a 7% growth pattern overall, and we maintain that current trajectory. In the same time, we've seen a 27% increase in EMS calls. These have been for various conditions, including stroke, myocardial infarction or heart attack, chest pain, and trauma. A topic very frequently discussed in the news this year is the subject of opiates, and I know that this was brought up at the public comment. Overdose, the use of Narcan, we see that as a fire department. Our EMS officer, Nate Denio, has provided some comparisons. In 2013, Hampton Fire had 2 overdoses and 2 uses of Narcan. In 2014, that number climbed to 13 overdoses, with Narcan being used 9 times. In 2015, we saw 16 overdoses with a total of 13 uses of Narcan. And unfortunately, in 2016, we see this trend continue with 17 overdoses and 13 uses of Narcan. I talked to Nate after supper, text message, and I asked whether or not we had any fatalities this year. And he told me that indeed we did. We saw 3 fatalities as a result of overdose this year. I'd like to say thank you very much for recognizing Dean. He did a tremendous job. He was recognized in person. The patient came to say thank you. And that happens quite a bit. And a lot of times it's off the cuff and they just say, hey, thanks a lot. And that means something, especially to the provider. Other things mean things too, right? We saw it tonight when Mrs. Nickerson received an award. You recognized 30 years of service. And we work very hard to provide our own standard of care and patient care. And in fact, I have the opportunity to inform you tonight that we've received notification that Hampton Fire Rescue will be receiving the Stroke Service of the Year Award from the Portsmouth Regional Hospital at a banquet next week. This award will be the 2nd year in a row that Hampton Fire Rescue has received this award. Additionally, we were told that firefighter paramedic Jeremy Timpson and firefighter advanced EMT Brian Akerley are receiving the Providers of the Year Award for the same. They have done a great job, and they are being recognized for the professionals we know them to be. Last year, firefighter AMT Damian Seven received the same award. 2 years running. I'm very proud of these guys. Fire prevention has not been immune to the increase in volume either. Year to date, we've completed 143 inspections, issued 60 permits, and collected a total of $6,878.55 in fees. When compared to last year, we saw 107 inspections, 70 permits issued, and a total of $3,744. In 2014, 60 inspections, 60 permits, and $1,800 in fees were collected. The summer season fast approaches. This is our high time. Hundreds of thousands of visitors will come to the town of Hampton and enjoy this beautiful, beautiful part of New England. We look forward to seeing them and off of this. Hampton Fire Rescue welcomes you, and we are here for you, whatever you may need. Thank you very much, and I'll answer any questions.
Great. Yeah? I don't have any questions, Great Report. Well, you know, 3 too many are the overdoses.
I agree.
But I'm glad you guys are keeping on top of everything. And
thank you, man.
Congratulations on your new engine.
Thank you. Nate has been doing a really great job. He has been in the community. He was invited to speak at the school board. He's been talking to parents. He's been very aggressive in making sure that everybody understands the position of Hampton Fire, making sure that our firefighters know what's going on and communicating. So I have to point that out there, too. He's doing a really tremendous job of this. So.
Yeah, thank you. Great report. Congratulations on all the awards and everything. That's really super. And congratulations on everything you've done for Kyle at the It's a team. That's really great. I mean, it's been a great effort and really appreciated, I'm sure.
Again, we thank you because I know that, you know, I've seen all your faces there at the fundraising events. Thank you very much for being there.
Great. Committing.
Phil?
No, thank you for the great work. Appreciate it, gentlemen. Thank you,
sir.
Thank you, sir.
Rick?
Yep, thank you. Excuse me. Thank you for your report. You did a great job. You know, obviously there's a problem with the substance abuse. I mean, when Mass General has to start locking the bathrooms because people are overdosing in the bathroom so they can get Narcan right there.
immediately. I'm sure we're going to have people, you know, that need it here in Hampton. And, you know, it's really, are you familiar with what Mrs. Terry was talking about?
Only slightly. I know that Nate has a greater degree of familiarity with it. And there's a great growth in available information, along with the ability to acquire Narcan, as you know, is what kind of what we're talking about here. Nate has spoken against the growth of that for a good reason. Narcan is not a benign drug, and it does a couple of things. So with the idea that there's more people doing drugs, what we need is more treatment centers, really. And we're seeing them come online, but they're slow. They're very difficult to first build, staff, maintain. They all have to be there. When we look at the problem of overdoses and the idea that Narcan might be a solution, to some problems it very well may. An opiate overdose is treated as an opiate overdose. However, there's a lot of categories that go into that. So OxyContin pills, we might see somebody taking. They might be doing injected heroin. Now acetylfentanyl happens to be the drug of choice, and it's one of the ones that's more prevalent. It's significantly stronger than heroin. So even our providers who know what to do when they're administering Narcan, and they're doing it IM or IV, that which is a preferred route for us, when they administer this life-saving drug, it's a very short-acting drug depending on the dose that the person might have taken. So the familiarity that people have with an overdose in their own community, whether it's their home, a brother, sister, aunt, uncle, and then saying, well, I have Narcan now, it's not an end-all, be-all. It's not a panacea. That doesn't cure the problem. The problem is that we have somebody who's addicted to opiates and needs treatment. Narcan will alleviate a situation that's going on right away, but they might need follow-up EMS within 10 minutes or whatever it might be, because it might not be working towards that situation. So I'm not familiar a great deal with what the Wahlberg video is going to be, but I do know that what's being promoted, especially at some of the groups that are going on, it deserves a lot of retrospection before you say yes to it, you know.
Mm-hmm. So. And where are these treatment centers? Where's the closest one to here?
I think there's one now that just opened in Manchester.
Yeah.
New.
Yeah, and like these methadone clinics, that used to be one in Somersworth. I have no idea. What?
There is still.
Is that still the main one?
There's one in Newington also.
Yeah, in Newington. Yeah, because like you say, they need to have more of these treatment centers. The problem is, they're like cell phone towers. No one wants them in their backyard.
True.
They'd rather have the dead bodies instead, I guess. But it's something that we all have to look for. But there are no treatment centers.
Certainly none local.
And that's been that way for 10, 20 years.
It's a very intensive treatment. You know, this is 24/7 care for somebody who is really sick. And you can reference somebody who's got a problem, you know. Well, they do something over there, they do something over there. When it comes to opiate overdose, they're physically addicted. And that means that it's not something that they can just walk away from. Their body needs it. So in order to treat that, you need somebody who is medically capable. You need a facility that can handle any type of reaction that they might have, the withdrawal symptoms and whatnot. Some of these people will be extremely aggressive at going out and getting a drug. When they're part of that treatment, they also need to, they understand that, but there's a psychological component too. It's a very large undertaking. It's not just going to be a house that's going to be dedicated towards treating these people. There are a lot of options out there right now that are going on. I know that we hear about clean shooting places, clean shooting galleries, so that you can go in and do your drugs in the presence of somebody who's medically trained to use Narcan, and they have Narcan there. That's not treating the underlying problem, you know. That's treating the symptom of what happens if you overdose, and that's it. So I think that there's a lot of growth potential here to do the right thing by the people who need the help.
Thank you.
Yes, sir.
You had spoken your facts and figures.
Yes, sir.
You talked over the past 3 years, you're up, what, 27%
in EMS, 17.5% for fire.
And I know your staffing at 9 is...
Well, we minimum staff at 8.
You minimum staff at 8.
Right.
Usually staff at 9.
Well, especially on paper, right? And you are no stranger to what's gone on in the last year in our fire department. Kyle being one of our long-term people who's been out ill. We've had two out that were out. One was is still out, remains out with a shoulder surgery post-op. We had one who had ACL repair, was out. He ended up coming back and doing light duty as a fire alarm operator in the absence of Bill while he was out. Last year, though, we had, I think we had three total shoulders, I believe, right? Three shoulder surgeries, and those recoveries are 6, 7, 8 months long. So to say that we're going to staff to 9, it wasn't possible because that would mean that I would be filling with overtime every group. If we are fully staffed and all of my people are healthy, then 9 is the minimum. When we have somebody sick or vacation, it's usually 8.
And how long's that been? 9.
Since you were there, I think, right?
Before I was there. Before, you know,
yeah.
You know, I was there, you know, a long time before I even retired, it was 9.
Sure.
And back then we didn't drop to 8. We stayed at 9.
Mm-hmm.
And we filled with that overtime. And I think at a rate of 27% in 3 years, it would be nice to, it would be helpful to hear any delays or response. I know a lot of times we send an engine, and yes, they have medical care, but actually getting an ambulance there.
I can tell you that if my memory serves, this year alone to this point, we've had 89 mutual aid calls that we've used outside agencies for ambulance. That's the year total. So this year we've had 25 mutual aid calls. When you look at that, and we are a nonprofit organization, that is not our purpose. We are here to help whoever calls us. You call us for help, we're going to go help you. Whether it's, you know, you've got a chimney fire or if you need help medically, anything you do, you call us, we're going to go. When it comes to medical aid, there is a fee for service and we charge insurance companies. If we are using mutual aid services, then they are charging for service.
So a potential of 89 times last year that we could have charged a fee, that went to somebody else.
Correct. 25 times this year so far.
25 just times this so year far. So far. So I think that's something we have to look at. I would rather have Hampton employees working on ambulances in the town of Hampton. And I think that at some point in time, you got to come back to us and look at what it would cost for man-for-man coverage, because I think that's important. I think, like you said, it's 27% in 3 years. I can only imagine what it's been since I left and the numbers are runs that it's gone up. And you're doing more with less. And every one of the guys is doing an excellent job.
As evidenced by what the community's
absolutely, by the awards you're getting and stuff like that. But I think we need to take a look at that. We've sometimes talked about putting on additional people, and sometimes that's very hard. And yes, you see people with salaries that get up there because they're working the overtime. But they're not working it because they want to. They're working it because we asked them to. And I think that's important to note. So I think at some point, I think you should come back to us with some sort of estimate of cost or what it would cost us to maintain 9.
I appreciate that, and I certainly will be doing that. And I would like to tell you that based on what we're seeing right now, the first ambulance out the door, the simultaneous second call, the subsequent third call, our volume, it's thinning the herd, as you might imagine. And we're now starting to track data on how many times the fire captains are essentially left alone at the fire station because all of our personnel are doing ambulance calls at that time. It's my intention to come back to you not only with the hard numbers, but also with an estimate for how many calls we've missed due to, or not necessarily missed, but have been delayed as a result of the fact that we haven't had the appropriate personnel. I'd like to see an ambulance down at the beach, personally. So
I would, too. I would, too. I think it's important. I know we're getting an engine down there right away to people. An engine can only do so much. Ambulance can do a lot better, and I think no matter where you live in this town, whether it's the beach of the town, you're entitled to that. And I think we need to look at that. Anything else? Very good. Thank you.
I do have one last piece of business, as evidenced by the...
I was just going to say.
Yep. Yeah,
the work is calm.
My last piece of business with you involves the fire prevention officer, Bill Payne. FPO Payne was determined to bring some high-quality education to the town of Hampton, and he called the State of New Hampshire Department of Safety and spoke with Ms. Mary McCaffrey. She was so impressed with his ideas that she nominated him to receive a scholarship to the National Fire Protection Agency conference in Las Vegas this June. This will be an all-expense-paid trip to attend the conference that will be that will offer a great deal of education for Bill, which he will in turn bring back to the town of Hampton. And I ask that you allow acceptance of this scholarship, which requires no outlay from the town of Hampton or the fire department. So,
I make a motion we accept it.
Second.
Very good. All those in favor? Just
super.
Just to that a little bit. He's okay with this and making sure that. I know June's a hard time for inspections. And
it is. And so the Bill works a 4-day work week, right? He has Mondays off currently. His part of the conference will be Friday, Saturday, and Sunday. He'll be coming home Sunday night. So it'll be Friday. And Deputy Kennedy and I are more than eager to take over any roles that we might have to help him out with that date.
Very good.
So super. Thank you.
Excellent.
Thank you.
All right.
Have a great night.
Thank you. You too. Next one is Jamie Sullivan.
Good evening.
Good evening.
So I'm here to talk to you tonight about the bidding, or I should say the process of choosing a provider for our workers' comp and property and liability. And how'd you like to proceed, Mr. Chairman? Do you want me to kind of just do the overview of where we're at?
Why don't you do an overview and kind of explain what both of them are like and what we've been used to?
Right.
Over the past number of years, right. Doing with the
So in the past, our provider for both of these or these services has been the Property Liability Trust, and some of you may be familiar, but they are essentially being forced out of provider business by the state and for some actions. So it's forced us and many other communities to go out and seek out another provider for those services. PLT. It was a community risk pool. It's a risk pool. So we are now left with one other risk pool provider in the state of New Hampshire, which is Primex. And then we also went out and tried to seek out bids and quotes from insurance. Now let's talk about the two a little bit. Risk pools are essentially, they look and sound like insurance. They provide coverages similar to insurance, but it's not insurance. They're regulated by two separate things. The Insurance Commission oversees insurance. It sets standards and requirements for what they do business. The trust, which is out of the Secretary of State's office, or the group that oversees that is the charitable trust divisions. They're the ones that oversee what happens with the trust. So there are rule differences. In our assessment, we went out to the market or to the insurance group to seek bids from them as well. And so we spent a lot of time as staff. Mr. Bean, with his expertise in insurance, was very helpful to us as well. And we tried to, as near as possible, take what our previous coverage was under PLT and compare that and use that as our baseline or increase in certain areas with our providers. We went out of the market. We were able to deal with one other provider. There were very few communities in the state that use traditional insurance, as we sort of all know it from our car insurance and home insurance. There's few providers, but we did have Davis and Toll out of Concord, New Hampshire, as one of those providers who came forward and quoted us policies from Travelers Insurance as the national provider and a number of other smaller specialty items for issues that are important to us. We had sought out other coverage as well. There are a few that offer it. And one of the other providers indicated they couldn't meet our timelines to give us the information we needed to analyze in the proper time. So we were left at looking with Davis and Toll through their Travelers primary policy and Primex. And again, what we did was take our past policy, sit down with what we saw as our risk and our issues, and tried as much as possible to put those to compare apples to apples. The initial bids that came in showed that the provider from Davis and Toll was lower by about $48,000 on its initial bids or initial proposals to us. We had to spend a series of time going through those proposals to make sure, again, we were comparing apples to apples. In things like your deductibles, for example. We all know if you have car insurance, you can choose a high deductible or a low deductible, and it affects your rates. The Primex, through the PLT, is very small deductibles, low deductibles, generally $1,000 deductibles for sort of car accidents, that type of stuff. And we wanted to make sure we normed those. On the other side, the deductibles were much higher. At one point, $10,000, $5,000, we quoted lower. So again, we compared those as near as possible, apples to apples. In the end, after we did an analysis of our number of accidents and things where those deductibles would come into play, we had to apply a factor basically to say, all right, this is going to be lower on this side for their initial bid, but we expect we're going to pay more deductibles from our experience over 3 years. We're going to pay this. So we factored that in to kind of equalize those, if that makes sense. In the end, essentially, it was like a $1,200 difference between the two. So the money of the actual fee in the case of Primex or the PL, the risk pool, and that for the providers wasn't a substantial issue. Then we went back in and looked at, okay, what are the coverage gaps? What are the risks? Where are the places that we don't feel we have sufficient coverage? And as we went through and compared all of those, it came down, and you'll see as we went through, sort of pros and cons in it. And the big ones were the coverage for flood zone issues. As you know, we have two significant buildings down in the flood zone areas. That is the police and fire stations down there. And through traditional insurance, it was much more costly to cover those buildings, and we don't get full coverage on them in what was proposed in front of us. So there is a gap there. Did a lot of work with that company. They quoted us some additional things to try and cover those risks and concerns we had. Additional FEMA insurance, as many folks who live on the beach have to get, and we wanted additional coverage, so we had to have a rider and additional coverage policy for that, which in the flood zone is a challenge and is expensive. And at some points, it started to get cost prohibitive to get full coverage. With Primex, we will see we are a part of, again, the group, or the other members all kind of come together, and through a membership agreement, we're going to cover one another. In the area of flood insurance, in our highest risk zone, there's a $10 million coverage of damages in it. One of the big things for us, as I went through and looked at all our buildings, we found that through our traditional insurance or through the Davis and Toll, none of our pump stations would be covered. You know, so that $2 million or so increase we did in the Church Street pump station, there would be no coverage if we had a loss in there due to flooding in that area. There is with Primex. We found that to be persuasive. And again, there are a number of other items like that, smaller ones, you know, a $5,000 legal coverage that was included in the Primex that isn't in the other one. We found that there's some process-wise risk management, good training. They're in Concord. They have a very robust training program. I looked at their offerings. Quite frankly, if you follow the recommendation, I expect I'll be taking advantage of a lot of their training myself. There are a number of discounts that are available to us. One we immediately are taking, and it's built into this number. Another one that'll take a little bit of work on our part, but not significant, I don't believe, to achieve that discount in the future. So again, I think our numbers can drop a little bit more. In the end, staff comparing all of that together, while we found that the folks from Davis and Toll were just incredibly responsive, they were great to work with. In the end, our assessment of what's going to provide the best coverage to the town of Hampton was to recommend to go with Primex and the risk pool.
Now, you put it out to other people other than Davis and Poole or whatever.
Yeah, and again, early on, they looked, and again, there's limited providers. In fact, I had a conversation today with the gentleman from Davis and Toll, and one of the concerns that is there aren't many providers that do this. The Primex is the lone surviving risk pool in the state of New Hampshire currently, with PLT going out, and there is a concern. Is there a competitive problem there? There are only, I think we found, four or five communities in the state who go out in traditional insurance, and many of those split it. They do workers' comp through Primex, but they do their property liability through the outside person. So it is not a common thing, but I know that they really pursued our business. They're interested in the business, but there are, again, some legal protections and issues that the risk pool has under the law that may or may not take place with primary insurance. So those were enough things that again, the staff crew, we went through each of these. It was our collective recommendation that we maintain with the risk pool and go with Primex.
Fred, would you like to speak on this?
No, I think Jamie's done an excellent job. The staff worked very well with him, and he worked very well with the staff. He spent a lot of time going through all of the individual little nitty-gritty pieces that compose these insurance policies. And the best proposition we have to present to you is the one he's presenting tonight, which is Primex.
Phil, would you like to?
Welcome to the nightmare.
Yeah. If I can just jump in before we start, okay. It's really going to recognize the finance department and Christy and her staff, who are outstanding at going through this stuff and the nitty-gritty. So, you know, kudos to them for their time and her time, especially on it.
Absolutely. Yeah, sir. The assistant town manager did an excellent job. Christy did under Fred's leadership. Very limited market speaks to the competitive bid process. Market. There's just, as you know, the problems with PLT, Primex, of course, a pool, and then the Travelers. It's nice to know through Jamie's efforts
and Christie's efforts that the Travelers is hot to trot. They will be back at you next year, I'm sure, and it keeps the pen sharp. So with what limited capabilities there are in the marketplace for securing coverage, with short notice, with the PLT debacle, Mr. Sullivan has acquitted himself with superlative performance, and we should be thankful for him.
Thank you. Rick?
That sounds to me like he's done a great job, just like almost everything that you do. Thank you.
Gina?
I agree. Sounds like great.
Thanks.
Yeah, good. I mean, I read the report that you provided us with and stuff, and I agree 100%.
So I think you're looking for a motion to go ahead with...
The motion and a vote, and then we'll begin the transition process, which will be, you know, lengthy.
I'll make that motion.
Motion by Rick, seconded by Bill. All those in favor? Unanimous.
Thank you.
Thank you, ladies and gentlemen.
Next thing we have is the approval of the minutes.
I make a motion we approve the minutes of April 25th, 2016.
I'll second that.
All right, we have a motion to approve them and seconded it. Is there any questions or admittance? All those in favor? Four, one abstain. It's not out of the room. Okay. Town Manager's report.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, just so everybody remembers that all 2015 dog licenses have expired. Please see the town clerk to re-register your dog in order to avoid penalties and other fees that will be added in accordance with state laws. And they add up very quickly, so please see them as soon as possible. A bid was awarded to the Dirt Doctor for the grinding and removal of brush, logs, wood, and wood chips as the lowest of three bidders. That's the public works facility.
Okay.
A bid was awarded to Howard Systems, LLC, as the lowest of five bidders for the replacement of the fire department telephone systems. I want to come back to that in a minute.
Okay.
I have nearly completed a long-range capital expenditures report for 2017, and subject to the availability of the copier that broke down the other day, I should have that to you by the end of the week. Please do not take it home and read it at night. It's not worth it. On the telephone systems of the fire department, we had encumbered funds last year at the end of the year to replace those systems. And upon examination, we found that there was something a little wrong with the bids or with the costs that we were given. So we actually went out to bid. We voided the encumbrance. We went out to bid. And we saved $10,000 over the figures we were given in December. So we've awarded that. We had five bidders. We've awarded it to the low bidder, who was not the person we had originally intended to have this work.
Is that the one that Mr. Sobedek had mentioned earlier?
Yes, it was. Okay. And it's been awarded to Howard Systems, which is, that's the same group of people who are going to be doing the installation of cameras at the police station.
So we know their work, because they've done it for us for many years at the police station.
They have, and it was interesting to note that we chopped $10,000 off the cost. So we saved 10. The original amount of money that you encumbered and carried forward has been put to the reserve, to the on expended fund balance at this point, and we have awarded that out of departmental expenses. So that's where that money came from and went to. So we've changed that a little bit. I have a couple of other things, Mr. Chairman. One is received an email, and I also received a telephone call from the Chief of Police today with regards to a paving that's going to be done at 939 Ocean Boulevard, which is up on the North Beach, right there in the Cusack Road complex. They have a number of cars that they have to move off of their property for 2 to 3 nights, and they would like to park on town property for that period of time because the paver won't let them drive the vehicles onto the new pavement. I spoke to the chief. He called me this afternoon on this subject, and he said it's not a problem. We have plenty of space. No reason why we shouldn't be able to let them do that. But since it's a board ordinance, I have to ask your permission to do it.
Do we make a motion that we do it?
I'll second it.
Motion and seconded. All those in favor? I think it's a good time of year to do it. If they came in July or June or August, that'd be one thing. But preseason in May, that lot's not.
They purposely set it for this time of the year so they wouldn't be interfering with them.
They're being smart, and so I think we can help them out.
I have another thing, Mr. Chairman, and that is that Of course, we've received our new fire engine, and the warrant article required that it either be traded in, sold, or auctioned. So the trade-in's gone because they wouldn't take it for a trade-in. I don't recommend the auction simply because it takes too much money out of what's retained by the town, and I would recommend that the board authorize us to advertise it for sale and see if we can get somebody to purchase it.
So you need a motion for that?
I do, sir.
I make a motion.
Motion.
Second.
Second. All those in favor?
Aye.
Okay. We had an interesting young man come in the other day, and he spoke to Christina, and I think you've all received this little item with regards to sidewalks. And it's been suggested that we invite him and his friends in who helped make this up to speak with the board and tell
That's
you
good idea.
What Absolutely. They think of the sidewalk systems.
Absolutely.
Why don't you invite them to come next week in the next 2 weeks when we have our meeting during public comment?
And we'll put them on it first.
Because they're little children. I noticed that their parents are some of the our fine, upstanding people here in Hampton.
And these are certainly fine, upstanding students here in
Absolutely.
Hampton. They came in and they were well prepared, believe me.
Well, maybe because it's early, they could come in and
have them do first thing, write a public comment, and we'll allow them to have some interaction.
We will extend a cordial invitation on behalf of the board to be present for the next meeting.
I was planning on doing that.
I think that's great. I think it's terrific. That's all I have, Mr. Chairman.
Anything for the town manager? Regina?
I don't have anything.
Nothing.
Phil?
Yeah, it was a big insurance night, Mr. Welch, and I know that there was an initial rejection or denial of the claim on the pipe, and I know you've resubmitted that, and we're waiting more than that.
We are.
Okay, thank you.
Yeah. We would like them to pay us. Thank you very much. And we're going to push until they do.
I'm glad to hear that you've taken that initiative, just like I'm glad to hear that you have taken the initiative
I think
to
that's
invite
great.
These young people, because that's why I went through the names, and I know several of the parents, and I was going to make sure to do that.
I think that's terrific.
It's beautiful.
You know, and I look at, like, some of the other good stuff you've done with this, like with this bid with the fire department on the phone system. You looked at it, you felt it was done, and so you went back out and rebid it, and I think that was the correct thing to do.
We try to look at all of those things as we go through the year and try to figure out what's really going on. And sometimes we have to change because it doesn't make sense to us. And we save money doing it.
And I agree with you. I hope everybody's got their dog licenses. I know Rhoda has hers.
Augie's got his.
And so we all have legal beagles here.
Okay.
That's not happened in years past, but...
Is this gentleman's name? Is his first name Jacques Thorne Strickland?
Well, I believe his real name is James, but he would like to learn French, so he's sort of adopted the name of Jacques.
Okay. Well, so that's interesting.
And he is, God, he's well-versed in what he's talking about.
I can tell.
Very good.
Yeah, it is. It's excellent.
Okay, so under old business, we've already talked about the HB 1198.
Yes, sir.
So the next thing is the vote of the U.S. Route 1 and New Hampshire 101 interchange realignment and intermodal transfer center.
That's a mouthful if I ever heard one.
Yeah, it is.
All right. We, based upon the discussion that the board had with regards to the intermodal transportation center, we drafted a motion, which you may or may not like or may not use, but the motion is to move that the Town of Hampton Board of Selectmen vote to deny the acceptance of the transit center facility that is suggested to be located at the interchange of United States Route 1 and New Hampshire Route 101 in Hampton. The Board of Selectmen's recommendation is that the proposed facility be located directly adjacent to Interstate 95 at Exit 2. As far as I went, I think that the subject matter should be kept open so that when we get to the center for the rail trail that's out there, that area might be used for something of that nature. And then that would be under town jurisdiction, not state jurisdiction. One of the things that was discussed by staff was that if we had suggested the parking lot be built by the state, that it might be 3, it may be 5, it may be 10 years later, but we'd have an interstate bus terminal there eventually. So we'd like to have something under the control of the town that the selectmen and the voters of the town could control. And the rail trail would provide that mechanism. So that's one of the reasons why we're recommending this.
Jim, you want to speak?
Yeah, I think getting it in the 10-year plan is a good idea. And I think going forward with this is a good idea. I think the bus is a bad idea. And I think the Rockingham Planning Commission addressed that in the letter that they sent us, mm-hmm. saying to take the bus totally out of the equation, to still continue.
We have a second motion for the road work.
Okay, but no, let me continue.
Yeah. Okay.
To continue along with this and to look at the land in there as a park type facility or something, and parking to connect the rail trail. And I think they've done a lot of work on this.
They have.
And I would like to go along with that.
And I would like to, that's part of what this process has been about. The process is about for what we're going to need 10 years from now. Let's let the people 10 years from now decide. We decided we don't want to have the so-called bus station there. But something else might be more usable 10 years from now. I don't think that's up for us to decide. I think that this needs to go just like it's gone. It's a working plan. It's a plan. We've decided we don't want the so-called bus station there. But what does need to be there needs to be decided 10 years from now when they need it, not now.
I agree with Rick on that 100%. I think we should, you know, leave it open. We don't want a bus station. So just leave it as is. And then in 10, 15 years, however long it is, look at it, see what needs to be done. There might be a better part of land or something better that where it can go at that time.
Bill.
Yeah. There was a public hearing by this board. Citizens came forward and they specifically responded to a plan by the Rockingham Planning Commission, the RPC. And it was to address that specific plan. And that's what the hearing was about. It wasn't about the supplementary or secondary information that was forwarded by the RPC. I haven't read that. We were specifically tasked, and you, Mr. Chairman, held your hearing Monday, April 11th, 2016, at 1900, to discuss a plan that was submitted. It wasn't the secondary plan. It was that plan. And there was widespread public negativity about that from denizens. There were health issues. They spoke loudly. I support the motion that's been prepared here as a draft. I move that the Town of Hampton and the Board of Selectmen vote to deny the acceptance of the Transit Center facility that is suggested to be located at the interchange of United States Route 1 and New Hampshire Route 101 in Hampton. The Board of Selectmen's recommendation is the proposed facility be located directly adjacent to the Interstate 95 at Exit 2. It is silent on your discussion tonight that you think it should be addressed 10 years from now by who's ever here 10 years from now. This motion that's been prepared by the town in response to the public and their testimony and their efforts specifically addresses that plan that was brought forward by the public hearing. They have not had it. The public has not been warned about any other discussion, any other plan B. So I make that motion. It remains silent about what you rightfully declare to be decided 10 years from now, if that is the case. But I make that motion.
I just want to address what you said, if I may.
Yep.
Thank you. The public came in, and what I heard from the public was they did not want a bus station. What I did hear was they did want a road plan. They did agree with the Rockingham Planning Commission on the interchange and that whole thing. And I agree 100% with that, that this plan, the Rockingham Planning Commission plan, needs to keep going forward. And I think it needs our support. And I agree 100%. And what the public said, what I heard very clearly, was no bus station. I heard from the people on Park Street, the interchange, they'd love to see that something done there because of the problems that exist. I heard from a lot of people, you know, that talked about the interchange and stuff. What I heard was no bus station. And I agree with that 100%. But I agree with the Rockingham Planning Commission. We still should go forward with that. With no bus station.
With no bus station. I think that some of the other stuff we heard loud and clear that night was that people were hesitant about these traffic circles, or roundabouts, as they call them.
Yeah.
People like the two-barrel, as they call it, yeah, two-barrel system. But there are definitely some deficiencies there with limited sight distance, with passing lanes and stuff that are done there, and that I think we can all agree that that's stuff that should be addressed and continue to be addressed. So I don't disagree with you, Phil, on your motion, but I think we also have to say that we are in support of them to continue working to make that area safer.
Well, I think there's a motion on the floor. It specifically addresses what the motion specifically addresses. If I may have the floor for a second, I made the motion. And that is the motion, and it's I'll read it again. Is I move that the Town of Hampton Board of Selectmen vote to deny the acceptance of a transit center facility. Remain silent on all of the things that you want to go forward with that is suggested to be located by virtue of their plan at the interchange of the United States Route 1 in New Hampshire Route 101 in Hampton. The Board of Selectmen's recommendation is that the proposed facility be located directly adjacent to Interstate 95 at Exit 2.
Okay.
It doesn't preclude anything that anybody else is saying here tonight.
And I say that, you know, let them bring another plan. That's what they're here for. They want to hear our input. They have heard our input. And the thing is, that's what we pay them $17,000 for, not just this year, but every other year. Of recent memory, they're paid to bring these plans forward.
I will second Phil's motion, and then I ask that I can make a motion after that.
Okay. So right now we have a motion that Selectman Bean has proposed. They have a motion seconded. All those in favor? All those opposed?
I don't understand what's going on.
His motion was to deny the acceptance of the transit station, the bus part of it.
And does it say bus part of it?
Yeah, the transit center.
It was their plan, the bus station.
And suggested that it be, you know, located at, you know, not be located at 101. And the board has recommended that they oppose facility, so they'd have to come back with a different plan to put it out at 95, basically.
I don't know. I'm voting against it.
Okay, so we have a 4-1 vote. That's good.
I make a motion that we support the Rockingham Planning Commission in going forward with their study.
I'll second it.
Going forth with their study.
And we've already said no bus station. We've said that in Phil's motion. We've said we will not accept a bus station.
I second it.
Discussion. Yeah, and now Mr. Welch is prepared in terms of that there was kind of a two-phase study. One was the intermodal, which was the bus station. We just had a motion on that.
Right.
That's not going to happen. Now, importantly, was the road. And Mr. Welch has prepared a motion for that. Does anybody want to read that? There's a draft here. So we can discuss that.
Okay, go ahead.
That has nothing to do with his motion. What he
has
just
everything
made.
To do with his motion.
No, it doesn't. He.
Well, then we can make. Then we can vote the motion down, and
that
we can talk about this. So
I disagree with that.
I agree
with his motion.
I support it too, and what I want to do is have specifics. Go ahead.
I made the motion.
I don't think there's enough specifics in your first motion.
I made the motion.
I don't.
And I accept that we can discuss that in discussion. I think we should be able to allow Fred to say what he's got to say.
Okay. So now that you've made the motion and it's been seconded, Fred, would you like to speak?
The motion that was prepared dealt with doing exactly that, continuing the study. for the interchange because something needs to happen there. It's a dangerous intersection. The problem is that that goes into the 10-year program, which traditionally is 20 to 25 years out before any work is accomplished. So when we looked at this, we said there are certain things that are there now that are extremely dangerous, and we listed six of them. Erect stop signs in place of the yield signs on both sides of the intersection of the westbound off-ramp from New Hampshire 101 to the entrance of US 1, that's the northbound, as you come off. The current yield sign is being ignored, causing constant runout from the current intersection of the ramp with US Route 1 and our Route 1 against moving traffic. 2, erect stop signs in place of the yield signs on both sides of the intersection of the eastbound off-ramp from 101 to Route 1. The current yield sign is being ignored, causing runout onto Route 1, causing accidents due to ignoring the yield. 3, it is recommended that state DOT remove the current railroad bridges and replace them with truck culverts that will lower the roadway and improve sight distances for southbound traffic on Route 1. These bridges will not have to be replaced as bridges in the future if they are replaced with culverts now. 4, if traffic runout is not stopped by the installation of stop signs, it is recommended that traffic lights be installed. Hopefully that doesn't happen. 5, investigate the installation of an acceleration lane for traffic moving to enter US Route 101 westbound by straightening out on the ramp and widening the bridge over Drakeside Road for a new on-ramp. Additional trees on the north side of Route 101 should be removed to improve sight distances for traffic entering Route 101 westbound. Investigate the removing the passing lane for northbound traffic on United States 1 on the south side of 101 by restricting the striping to a single lane until after its intersection with Tri-Rental by providing a center turn lane for that facility. Those were the six items that we considered.
So I think these six items, yeah, there is some cost to it, but it's also safety related, and it's stuff that we would like to see looked at sooner than later.
We currently have about 25 accidents a year there,
and we've had several deaths. It doesn't preclude this plan going forward.
No, it recommends it go forward.
So this recommends this plan continues.
Right.
And that they take action on those.
On the emergency items.
On the emergency items.
Because the long-range plan for the 10-year program, as we know, often runs out to 20 or 25 years. And at 25 accidents a year, that's a lot of injury and damage to property and people.
As it says here, the Town of Hampton Board of Selectmen recommends the continued study of the proposals of realignment for the interchange with US Route 1 and 101.
And what about the other things that might happen there?
Well, that's
why this word, transit center, is very similar to what happened in 1933 at the beach. It says very little. A transit center, or we were referring to that we don't want the buses that are picking up people and taking them to Boston. That's one thing.
We took exactly the wording they had as transit center. So that's why we said no to that. So we said no to what they asked for. They asked for, and it says, transit center feasibility study. So we answered what the question that they asked for.
Okay, well, the other uses for the property aren't being left open, from what I can see.
I think that
we've been silent. We've been silent.
I know, and it doesn't look to me like, it looks to me like there'll be a big argument about this sometime in the future. It doesn't mention about what could be. Phil, please don't be so condescending to me, because I don't appreciate it.
I'm not being
other
condescending.
Other people maybe it worked with, but it won't work with me.
I'm not being condescending.
Okay, well, don't be.
Okay, right.
I just think that, I don't know. I
think our motion we made before addressed exactly how they worded it. And I think that's what we want to do. We want to make sure we word it exactly how they did. As far as other things that could go in there in the potential, that's still there. We were silent on that. We haven't said anything about it.
And now you're talking about a motion that strictly has to do with the road.
This is on the first part.
Okay.
U.S.
Well, right. Their study through the years has been a lot more of other items, including what you just mentioned about maybe there would be the rails to trail.
But that's all being excluded. They didn't bring that to us.
Okay.
But we haven't excluded that.
No, we haven't.
That's what it sounds like to me. That
no.
I don't believe we've excluded it. I think we've said continue with this, and we need emergency things taking place before the 10 years.
One of the reasons we wrote this way, Rick, was because we didn't want to exclude anything. Could be anything could happen.
Well, I hope that's the way it is.
And I think
literally,
I want the record to reflect that.
Right. And I think consensus of this board is we all realize that there could be other things that could go on there, and we don't want to stifle that.
Right. Can I say something? I just want to, Rick, yeah, I think we don't want buses, so that's like what the first motion's for. And then the second one, we're not saying we're not going to completely shut down the project because who knows what's going to happen. You know, like we said, leave it open, let it go on for another 10, 15 years. We can vote no in 10 or 15 years if we don't like it again. But we need something done in that intersection now, right? That's right. All we, so we're trying to say, you know, listen, we we'll can't wait 15, 20 years. Yeah, well, but hopefully if maybe they will, you know, I mean, it might be better than 20, 25 years.
My motion, I'm going to amend my motion
to this,
to continue the Rockingham Planning Commission study.
The realignment,
their study, to support that, and to request the emergency.
And send our recommendations along with it.
Yes.
Yeah. So I have a motion now.
Second.
All those in favor? Unanimous. Thank you.
That went quicker than I thought.
Well done, Mr. Chairman. Okay. Now, Rick, you wanted to bring up under old business, you wanted to bring up the purchase policy.
Yeah, let me explain it. First of all, we have people coming. Mr. Silberdick seems to come every week about the purchasing policy. Now, I don't know all the people that are part of the Rational Taxpayers of Hampton, but I do know that there is at least three ex-selectmen that are a member of that. They're the ones that came up with the purchasing policy. They made the purchasing policy. So, of course, they're going to be able to be complaining about it. Now, we need to maybe take a look at the purchasing policy, make sure it has to do about the lack of bids and about the matching equipment. These things are mentioned because that purchasing policy was done by at least two of those, if not three of those, former selectmen that are on that Rational Taxpayers.
Yeah, you're correct.
Well, I don't know who's on that group other than the five that were in the paper. So
I don't.
That equals what I just said.
I just like to say I don't care about that group. And I don't think that enters into the conversation. If we need to look at our purchasing policy, we need to look at our purchasing policy. And I make a motion that
instruct Fred to
draw up a
come back with a proposal.
Proposal on a on the purchasing policy if we need to change it because we're not getting bids, and to explain specifically what it is, and we'll go through that.
Okay. I mean, obviously it's a problem when there's four in a row.
Right.
Absolutely.
Right. Yeah. It's a big problem.
So we have a motion by Jim to ask the town manager to come back with some recommendations and
on the purchasing
on the policy.
Have that policy tomorrow.
Do I have a second?
Yo.
All those in favor? Unanimous. Anything else in the old business? New business.
Good call.
Correction to code 769-57, noise hour operation, subsection C.
We keep on getting calls, and people don't understand the ordinance. So Christina suggested that, and she wrote this up, that we eliminate certain things that are in here that are and highlight other things that don't need to be misunderstood. So the ordinance, the current section C, would read, normal hours, this is noise and hours of operation. Normal hours of operation shall be between 7 a.m. and 7 p.m. Monday through Friday, and between 9 a.m. and 5 p.m. on any weekday or any holiday, except with the express written permission of the director. This goes to road work. That sort of material where
so that last one was
everybody,
weekends.
Yeah.
Except you said weekday.
Did I say weekday?
Yeah.
Weekend. I'm sorry. It's weekend. Any weekend or any holiday. And so it restricts those hours of operation.
And obviously, if we had something that was due to an emergency,
the director could allow that.
I make a motion that we accept that.
I'll second.
Any questions? All's in favor? ERZ application for the car barn designation, ERX.
Okay, why don't I just take all three of them together, Mr. Chairman? You remember we had a designation for the commercial zone, the industrial zone, excuse me, on Tide Mill Road. And this is a state program. It's funded by the state of New Hampshire. There are no tax dollars applied by the town. There's no loss of tax dollars to the town. This program is based upon the ability of owners of property within a particular district as designated by the selectmen and approved by the state to receive remuneration from the state of New Hampshire for enlarging facilities and hiring new employees. Those are the only real criteria to this program. So if someone, for instance, and I'll use the example of the one that we had before, because I think that was something that was really, really wonderful. We have a vendor down on Tide Mill Road who was closing, Brizonics, who was closing a facility in Massachusetts. They want to build a large addition to their facility here, and they want to bring a lot of employees, all their employees from Massachusetts, just across the state line up here to work. That will give them credits on their state taxes that they have to pay for the production of materials. And those credits can be paid back to them in money to help pay back this expense. So the whole program is based upon increasing employees and providing new facilities. But without town involvement, they still have to go through all of our regulations. They still have to go through site plan. They still have to go through the zoning board if necessary. And but they receive some state reimbursement for actually doing the building and increasing their productivity. It's a good deal.
I make a motion we do the ERZ zone applicants for the three Car Barn, Liberty Lane, and Merrill Industrial.
I'll second it.
Any questions? All those in favor? Unanimous.
I guess the only question I got is, do you want to do the one on Route 1? There is an industrial zone on Route 1 on the west side of Route 1, the town line down not quite to... Exeter Road.
For
it's
west
a combination of, industrial business.
West of the tracks?
Yes, yeah. I think it's the only one we haven't done.
What do you recommend?
Well, there may be some businesses in there that want to expand or want to do some rebuilding and maybe some enlargement, and they could receive some assistance from the state to do it.
And if you would modify our motion specifically to address that, can you do that now?
No, I've got to do the paperwork.
Okay, great.
So I will do the paperwork and bring it back to you. And so you can review it and then make a decision at that point.
Okay. Is there any other new business?
I make a motion that we postpone, that we adjourn at 2202.
If I might just request that rather than adjourning, that you take a roll call vote to go into a non-public session. Under RSA 91-A:3, Roman 2, small c, reputation, and e, pending claims or litigation.
Say a motion by Jim, seconded by Phil, to go into a non-public. As stated below, all those in favor of the roll call? Aye.
Good night, Max. Good night, Brian.
All those said, we're going to non-public.
What is that?